The wait is over, and after months of analysis and speculation, the top NHL prospects, in a matter of moments, they're going to have a new home. Montreal hosting the draft for the first time since 2009, and also holding down the first overall pick. The teams are ready, the prospects are ready, and yes, the fans are ready too. The 2022 NHL Entry Draft, hydrated by BioSteel, starts now.
Canada, you ready? It's that time of the year again. You know, the tailored suits, the sweaty palms, the mic drops.
Philadelphia selects Brooklyn, forget it.
Oh, watch your step, kid. And the highly emotional, awkward hugs. It's the 2022 NHL Entry Draft, live from Montreal. That's right, y'all. No more virtual drafts. We're back in person.
Shot coming, they score. Oh my goodness, what a shot by Shane Wright.
Logan Cooley, wizardry from behind the net.
Savoy shooting, he scores.
So, who's got next? Who's going first?
My game is far from the best, and it can still be like way, way better.
I think I've proved it, you know, the past 2 years. I feel like I'm an electrifying player to watch.
I believe that I'm deserving of being that number one spot, and I believe that I'm going to be the first pick.
And if you don't know who these guys are, well, now you'll know.
I'm a big singer. I like to sing in the car.
I don't have the vocals for that. That's his thing.
No one ever understood a single word he said.
How's hair looking? Solid? All right. A little product in there, you know, have to make it look good for TV, right?
Okay, let's blow this up with a bit of history to set the stakes. The last time the Canadians had the first overall pick, they took this guy over this guy.
Here's Savard, look at the movie score!
And that guy.
Here's Poppy on a rush, right in, shoot, scores!
The last time the draft was in Montreal, a bag of future stars were taken. But back tonight, where they say, dreams will be made, tears will be shed. A lifetime of work will be rewarded, and maybe a few hearts will be broken. Enough cliches, let's go.
Montreal will have the first selection.
So let's get started.
Oh, what an atmosphere here in Montreal. And remember, thanks to COVID, it was a two-year wait for this city to host the draft. But finally, we're here. The Canadians ready to announce the next foundational piece to their historic franchise. The big question, Shane Wright or Jure Slafkovský? That is the question as Montreal prepares to make the first pick in the 2022 NHL Entry Draft. And yes, welcome into Montreal. What a scene it is here. It's been so much fun. The city is buzzing. I can tell you, the building is electric as well as we welcome in Sam Costantino, as well as Pierre Maguire, Jason Bukala. All right, guys, the intrigue's about to be answered, but what's most intriguing as we set up tonight?
We're minutes before this thing. We have no idea who's going number one. And we knew when it was McDavid, and we knew when it was Matthews, and we knew all about what that number one pick would be in most drafts. But here we're sitting here. We have no clue what's going to happen. Is it Slafkovský? Is it right? Or do they throw a curveball right off the hop here? This building is electric in anticipation.
No question about it. I think the biggest thing, though, when you think about it, the Canadians can go in one of two directions. Get the real talented 200-foot player, or get the power forward, Sam, that a lot of people want to have on their team in the NHL, but they don't draft them. And that's the big thing. That's going to be their biggest question, I think, going into who's going to go number one. Is it the power forward or the 200-foot player?
I don't disagree with what you guys are saying. Clearly, you know, the Canadians are in a win-win situation. Let's be honest here. They're going to beef up on the wing if they go with Slafkovský. They're going to get a 200-foot player similar to Suzuki in Wright. If they go another way and they go to Cooley, they get a 1A guy who plays a lighter game, more offensive upside. Either way, all three ways, the team's improving today. I'm interested to see what the fans want and what this building does in the next 10 minutes or so.
And that's part of the story. There's maybe a little bit of added pressure to Kent Hughes, Jeff Gorton, and all the gang, because they're in front of their home crowd.
No question. But when you have a situation where you're looking and you're talking about, hey, we've got 14 picks, you come in as a new general manager, what more could you possibly ask for? You have the number one pick in your own barn. What more could you ask for? What I will say about this new group with Jeff Sport and Ken Hughes, they are not afraid to go against the grain. If they feel very strongly about Slafkovský, maybe that's not the popular pick here in the building. That's the road they're going to go down. And how can you argue, especially with Jeff Gordon's experience, what he did with the New York Rangers and how quickly they got near the top of the mountain with his rebuild?
That's the key point, David, and I agree with you 100%, Sam. The truth of the matter is, when you really think about this whole thing, the experience of Jeff Gordon helping a first-time general manager like Ken Hughes get through this, that makes a world of difference when it comes down to drafting and identifying a key point in your development.
If the appetite is for immediate impact, it's going to be Slafkovský, in my opinion. I'm not going to overthink this. He's the most pro-ready body. That would be the guy if you're looking for somebody immediately.
Oh, so many decisions. We're going to hear from Kyle Bukauskas and Carolyn Cameron. We have a group of analysts ready to go, but we're going to start with our insiders, Jeff Merrick and Elliot Friedman. Lots of news to break. Elliot, we start with you.
All right, just a few things I'm keeping an eye on. Spoke briefly to Tom Fitzgerald, who has the number two pick with New Jersey. He said talks slowed down a bit today. We'll see what happens with number one, and then if things pick up at the Devil's table. Just recently, Minnesota announced they've re-signed Marc-Andre Fleury to a two-year deal, $3.5 million per season. And guys, I'm starting to hear some rumblings about the Islanders' first-round pick. I wonder if that's a potential JT Miller destination. I think the Islanders' first-round pick is in play. Jeff, what do you have?
A couple of things. What we're wondering about, Elliot, is are there any teams in advance of free agency next week willing to attach their first-round draft pick to a bad contract to get some cap relief and maybe make some space? And Elliot, one of the teams that I think a lot of people are wondering about are the Philadelphia Flyers. They will draft fifth overall. And as much as the speculation has been about Shane Wright and Yuri Slafkovský, you know, one general manager told me yesterday, I don't care to read any of your lists. This whole thing is going to be a spree. You know, there is some talk and there's some speculation that maybe at 2-3, we see New Jersey taking David Juracek, the defenseman, and maybe Cutter Gauthier from Scottsdale, Arizona, the local boy goes home story, becomes a member of the Arizona Coyotes. Now, when Charles Barkley calls you Canada's Tom Brady, you step up your game. So in that spirit, from Campbell River, the runways of Campbell River, yes, to the runways of Montreal, the new Canadian hotness, ladies and gentlemen, Al Bukauskas.
I think this will be my last day in broadcasting, Jeff, after that intro. The hottest ticket in town here tonight, but admission is free in the section behind me. The top prospects, along with their families and special guests, Wright and Slafkovský, front and center. When a player hears his name called here tonight, they will make their way down the stairs and then along this runway. And there you see the words over there, welcome to the NHL. That's what they will be greeted with by Commissioner Gary Bettman once they reach the stage. And then for the first time since 2019, an opportunity for a handshake and a photo op with the organization that will have changed their lives forever. The nervous energy is palpable, Carolyn Cameron.
I was nervous for that walk. I don't know how to follow that up, Kyle. So yes, I have the easy, comfortable job of sitting just off stage, and this is where I'll be met with the new members of the NHL family right after they get drafted, right after they shake Gary Bettman's hand and take that picture. We'll hear them reflect on their journey and their future home, and hopefully for my sake, David, they won't be speechless.
Yeah, let's hope you can get the good juice out of them. I love Jeff and Elliot just coming in with these trade grenades and walking away. But can you speak to the pressure, guys, that the GMs are feeling? 21 of the 32 GMs were hired in the last 5 years. It is a win now situation.
Especially when you're coming off COVID, you're talking about revenues. Playoffs are a revenue generator, and so it's really important to get better quickly, and we see a lot of teams, especially in the top 10, that are sitting in that exact spot.
There's no question about it. I think there's going to be a lot of scrutiny and a lot of pressure on a lot of general managers, probably more so than what we've seen over the last 3 or 4 years anyways.
GMs need a runway of at least 5 years in this league to establish what they want out of their group. Let's hope there's a little more stability going forward.
All right, well, again, we set the stage. We have a lot of different opinions as far as who the Montreal Canadiens are going to pick first overall. In a matter of moments, there'll be no more mystery. We'll have an answer. It may be Shane Wright. We will wait and see. The 2022 NHL entry draft, it is set to begin in a matter of moments. Commissioner Gary Bettman will be taking the podium, a special celebration as well. It's all coming your way. We will find out who the Habs pick in a matter of moments. To the Commissioner, Gary Bettman.
Daniel Bossy, daughter of Mike Bossy, et le commissaire de la LNH,
NHL Commissioner Gary Bettman. Bonsoir, Montréal. Bienvenue au repêchage de la Ligue nationale du hockey Upper Deck 2022. Commencion, son courtois. We are, I am delighted to be conducting a draft in person again, and thank you for that welcome. It is a return to normalcy. We are thrilled that the draft is in the city that has played host to the first NHL draft back in 1963 and has been home to the most NHL drafts since. I'm not sure why you're booing that. It's your city. But on a serious note, we had a tragedy here in Montreal yesterday with the untimely passing of Brian Marchment, who was here in his capacity with the San Jose Sharks. Obviously, our condolences, the condolences of the entire NHL family, go out to Brian's family and friends. And I'd ask everybody to stand for a moment of silence in Brian's memory. Thank you. You'll have to hold it for a second. Wait a minute. I'm now honored to be accompanied tonight by Tanya Bossy and Martin LaFleur. Within a span of 8 days in April, the NHL lost two of its most legendary players, and Montreal lost two of its most beloved sons, and most important, Tanya and Martin lost their cherished fathers. We still and always will feel their losses deeply. But tonight, we celebrate their lives. And we recall that the remarkable careers of both Guy LaFleur and Mike Bossy began on nights such as this at NHL drafts held in Montreal.
Mon père a grandi dans un village qui s'appelait Tursault. Un jour, il rêvait, comme son idole, Jean Béliveau, de faire la Ligue nationale. In 1971, thanks to Sam Pollock's wizardry, the Montreal Canadiens drafted my father. Mon père m'a dit, il y a un bout de temps, le sentiment d'être repêché est aussi grand que de gagner la Coupe Stanley ou tous les autres honneurs ou accolades qu'on peut recevoir en performant dans la Ligue nationale. Parce que la Ligue nationale est le summum du hockey au monde. The LaFleur family would like to wish the best of luck to all the players who are eligible for the 2022 NHL Draft. Enjoy this moment. It's once in a lifetime. Thank you. Merci.
Mon père avait un rêve, celui de jouer dans la LNH et de briser des records. Il y a 45 ans, il a été repêché par les Islanders de New York et bien inspiré par Guy Lafleur. Sans doute bien inspiré par Guy Lafleur, il avait même affirmé au directeur général qu'il compterait 50 buts dès sa première saison. Eh bien, c'est avec ce gilet des Islanders qu'il en a marqué finalement 53. My father's dream was to play in the NHL. My father's dream was to play in the NHL. 45 years ago, he was drafted by the New York Islanders, and he told the GM that he would score 50 goals during his first season. Well inspired by Guy Lafleur and wearing this jersey, he scored 53. Despite his shortened life and career, my dad's dream came true. And if he was here tonight, he would tell you to dream big as you can. Malgré une vie et une carrière écourtée, mon père a accompli son but et plus encore. S'il était présent ici ce soir, il vous dirait à tous de rêver grand, très grand. Merci. Thank you.
Merci, Tanya and Martin, for being here tonight. Before we get down to this evening's business, we have another special guest. Canadiens head coach, Martin St-Louis.
See. Merci. 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 Martin et Tanya, je suis content que vous êtes ici. Tanya, ton père a passé beaucoup de temps à Laval. Il a inspiré beaucoup de jeunes Lavalois comme moi quand on était jeunes. Martin, ton père, c'était l'idole de la province. OK? Il nous a fait vivre des moments inoubliables comme fans du Canadien. Merci d'être ici. Bienvenue au repêchage, bienvenue à tous les fans du hockey, mais spécialement à nos fans des Canadiens. Encore une fois, à guichet fermé, vous êtes vraiment extraordinaires. Merci. It took me 47 years to finally be at my first draft. And it was worth the wait. The last 2 days, the energy in this city has been awesome. Merci, Montréal. Congratulations to all the players that are going to hear their names in the next 2 days. Understand that it's just the beginning. It's probably the easy part. What's ahead of you is going to be much harder. And for the guys that don't hear your name, it's okay. It's not the end. You just keep pushing. You match work ethic with will. You can accomplish anything. Encore une fois, merci beaucoup. Amusez-vous ce soir. Et go Habs, go!
Merci, Martin. Why can't I get some of that? Anyway, thank you to Jeff Molson and the entire Canadiens organization for being such terrific hosts. My thanks as well to Mayor Valerie Plante and the City of Montreal for the warm welcome you have extended to most of the NHL family this week. Congratulations to all of the draft-eligible prospects who are here in the Bell Centre and on your hockey journey thus far. Good luck as you wait to hear your names called over the next 2 days. And thank you to all of the parents, family members, friends, and coaches whose support was essential to every one of these hockey journeys. Finally, welcome to those watching on TVR Sports, Sportsnet, ESPN, and the NHL Network. La première sélection à Tienne au Canadien du Montréal. The first selection in the 2022 NHL Draft belongs to the Montreal Canadiens. Montréal. A vous la parole. Montreal, you are on the clock.
I truly believe that every player in the NHL should have an opportunity to play for your Montreal Canadiens.
Fantastic ovation for Martin Lafleur, for Tanya Bossy, and for Martin St-Louis. And a good point he brought up, gentlemen, undrafted. If your name is not called in the next 2 days, your NHL dream doesn't necessarily die. So that's a good message to all those players who won't hear their name called. But in a matter of moments, Sam, we are going to hear a player's name called, the newest member of the Montreal Canadiens. Give us a sense of the anticipation, but also what we might see in the next couple of minutes.
It's going to be absolutely fascinating. I think we can pick a list of 10 names that will comfortably fill those 10 spots, but after that, there are no discernible ledges, and that's what makes this thing interesting. You can look at number one right now. Is it Slavkovsky? Is it right? Maybe Logan Cooley. Pretty awesome. We still don't know.
Well, the one guy that I would look to in part of this decision, not just Marty Lapointe, Nick Bobrov, who is a scout that spent a lot of time over in Europe. He came over from the New York Rangers with Jeff Gorton, so he knows the European component extremely well.
I enjoyed a flight to Europe to the under-18s this year in Germany with Marty Lapointe, and we picked each other's brains for 8 hours or so. I can tell you that he was stressed, but at the same time excited about the opportunity. It doesn't get any better than this, fellas, right here in Montreal.
I'll just say one thing. It's hard to teach big. Juraj Slafkovský is big. He's a big man, and he reminds you a little bit of Jaromir Jagr, the way he plays.
6'4", 229. Whatever happens, we're going to see some history here. Shane Wright would be the highest pick ever from the Kingston Frontenacs, their OHL team. Erik Gudbranson, Chris Gratton were selected third overall. Or Jure Slavkovský could be the highest pick Slovakian we've ever seen, the highest pick to date. Marian Gaborik picked third overall back in 2000.
Well, you have to love either player you're going to get. In order to win a Stanley Cup, you need both of those types of players. You need heaviness on the wing, but you also need those two-way centers. You look at Bergeron, you look at guys like Jagr, both very successful.
No team will be busier tonight than the Montreal Canadiens. 14 picks, tied for the most since 2004 with the Chicago Blackhawks. Kent Hughes and all the brass are heading to the podium as Montreal will make the first overall pick for the first time since 1980. Let's take a listen to Kent Hughes and the Habs about to make their pick.
Bonsoir tout le monde, bonsoir à nos partisans. Merci beaucoup pour votre soutien incroyable. Je veux aussi souhaiter bienvenue aux espoirs et leur famille. I would like to thank and welcome all the prospects and their families to Montreal. On behalf of the Montreal Canadiens organization, we would like to extend our deepest condolences to the Marchment family and to the San Jose Sharks for the untimely passing of Brian. Congratulations to Joe Sakic and the Colorado Avalanche. Avec notre premier choix au repêchage, with our first pick in the 2022 NHL draft, les Canadiens de Montréal sont fiers de repêcher from the Slovakian national team and TPS Turku, Jure Slavkovský.
Mom and dad, and this guy, when he walks into a room, man, he is a monster, yet he's still got that baby face. What it says to me is that there's a ton of growth potential remaining with this young man, and his career is interesting so far. When you look at his draft year here, he had 4 points in his first 26 games. All of a sudden, he goes to the Olympics, Craig Ramsey, they open things up for him a little bit. Hey, son, shoot the puck, shoot the puck. He says, okay, picks up the MVP, 7 goals in 7 games. Comes back after that, really starts to gain that confidence, really good in the playoffs, the men's worlds, and now you're looking at a guy with 70-plus games of experience against men in high-level competition, and I think that's what sold the Montreal Canadiens to make him number one.
I'll just tell you this. I saw him a ton this year, live and on tape. The thing that's impressive about him, when he was playing for Turku, he was on the third line, and he was kind of buried there. When he went to international events, he wasn't buried, and he produced. I also saw him, the men in the puck, playing with men. He was telling guys, get me the puck, and I'll take charge of the game. And when he got the puck, he did take charge of the game, Sam, David, and Jason. I like this pick a ton. I think the Canadiens have really speeded up their rebuilding process by getting Slavkovský.
I think the happiest guy on stage, besides in the building here, is Nick Suzuki watching this giant walk up there. Look at that hug. I mean, this guy's a power winger. He's going to be streaky, though, guys. So let's not just throw all the eggs in one basket and think it's going to be a smooth journey. It's going to take some time here.
Yep.
last draft, the Montreal Canadiens took four defensemen. The year before that, in the first round, they took another defenseman, Caden Gooley. This is a team that is really deep with a back-end prospect pool. Jordan Harris, 10 games with the Habs. Caden Gooley, I just mentioned. Jaden Struble. Justin Barron, who came over in the Arturi Lehkonen trade. Matthias Norlander, 6 games with Montreal this season. A really deep prospect pool, and they're going to need some of these players to start hitting ASAP on the back end. But then the question has always become, well, what about the players up front? You know, the Ben Chiarot trade brought Ty Smolanik along with it, transferring from Wisconsin to Quinnipiac. Emil Heinemann in the Toffoli trade, he joins the Montreal Canadiens organization. But now the top forward prospect for the Montreal Canadiens is Jurij Slafkovský, who's standing by with Carolyn Cameron.
The second selection in the 2022.
Well, you're right. Your eyes went wide when you heard your name called with so much speculation in a two-horse race for first overall. When did you get a sense that it might be you?
Actually, it was sometime after the World Champions when I was on Combine. I felt like they are pretty interested. And yeah, today's meeting, I just didn't know what to expect. And I think it was good. And when I heard from Slovakia now, I was like, wow.
Well, after you won bronze at the Olympics, you got some special messages from Marian Hossa. Tonight, we actually have another special message for you, so just watch that monitor.
Oh, you're right, this is Big V. Want to congratulate you to being drafted. Takisto ti gratulujem k tomu, že si bol draftovaný do NHL. Prajem ti dlhú kariéru, úspešnú kariéru, nech sa ti darí a drž sa. Aj sa pekne, ahoj.
What does it mean to hear that from Zdeno Chara?
Yeah, it's unbelievable. Legend of Slovak hockey, legend of NHL. Feels great.
And now you're the first Slovakian to ever be drafted first overall. What do you think the celebration is like right now in Slovakia?
I think people are crazy. Yeah, they have to be. I hope, yeah.
Middle of the night, doesn't matter. Yeah, the party's going on.
They are all awake.
Yeah. Congratulations, Chara.
Thank you very much.
And yes, it is a historic moment for Slafkovský.
Well, how about this guy? The big man uses his body, and it doesn't matter what competition he's playing against. You see, he does a great job here. Circles out of the corner after the forecheck, no problem. Put it into the back of the net. Here, a little bit of space anticipation. Picks off a puck. Oh, no, I'm not going to go to the short side. I'm going to use those great hands and that reach to extend past the goaltender. No problem here as well. Off the post and in. Going to the blocker side. Thank you very much. I mean, it's amazing what's happened to this country here in such a short time. And you think about their first ever medal at the Olympics, this is a large reason why.
Well, they're dancing in Bratislava right now, but remember this great player, Peter Stastny, a Hockey Hall of Famer. He could shoot the puck, he could dominate you physically, he was great on faceoff plays. We talk about Slafkovský in the power game, where do you think he got it? Watching tapes of Peter Stastny. I'm not trying to say he's going to be a Hall of Famer, but man oh man, Stastny was a dominant big body player, and I think you're right, Slafkovský can be much the same because of his ability to dominate the puck, create chances off the forecheck, drive to the net, and not be overrun by anybody.
All right, well, a historic moment. I should mention it was mostly cheers here in Montreal for that pick. There was a smattering maybe of surprise, but it was mostly cheers. And look at this list, Jason, that he follows in. Wickenheiser, Lafleur, Uhl, etc. Big feet there and big shoes to follow. And now we have New Jersey coming up at number two. Is it locked in to Shane Wright?
Well, I don't know, to be perfectly honest. I mean, they are kind of stacked in the middle of the ice right now. I will say this, if they do go with Shane Wright in this slot, I think it's going to open up some opportunities for active NHL bodies on the New Jersey Devils to be moved out in short order so that they can fill some other voids in their lineup. If they think Wright and Eshire, or Wright and Hughes, most likely, are going to be the two guys with Eshire, Pavel Zacha, I'm just throwing names out there right now. If this is Wright, expect New Jersey to move out somebody else.
All right, let's get back on the floor. We have Elliot Friedman and Kent Hughes.
New Jersey's just coming up in a couple seconds, so just take us through the final decision.
Well, I had mentioned it earlier this week, we were down to three prospects, and we felt like we had done a real thorough review of them, both, you know, in person as well as in video. I would say probably Wednesday morning, the group was at a point where we were definitely leaning toward Juraj, but we wanted to meet him one more time, ask some important questions that we feel needed to be answered. He passed with flying colors, and here we are.
Is there anything particular he said that convinced you?
You know what? It's more, he's got a really dynamic personality. He's very charismatic, but we asked him a certain question, like, what is the best moment for you in hockey? And he said, when we're winning by a goal or losing by a goal, and the game's on the line.
Congratulations, Ken. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Al.
Devils are up next.
Yeah, the Canadians have their guy, Elliot, and now New Jersey's stepping to the podium. Executive VP Hall of Famer Martin Brodeur expected to make the announcement with the number two pick in the 2022 NHL draft. Let's take a look and a listen to the Devils on the podium.
Bonsoir, Montréal. J'aimerais remercier la ville de Montréal, Jeffrey Molson, et le Canadien de Montréal pour la belle hospitalité pour toute la semaine. Merci beaucoup. Also, I'd like to say hi to all our fans back in New Jersey at the Stone Pony at our draft party. Pour nommer la sélection, la nouvelle assistante gérante, Kate Madigan.
Merci. Et avec le deuxième choix, le Devils du New Jersey, with the second selection, the New Jersey Devils are proud to select, from Nitra, Simon Nemec.
Well, it's a Slovakian sweep of the first two picks. We weren't sure who was going to go at one, but this is a bit of a surprise at number two. Pierre, your thoughts?
I'm not surprised at all. I just wrote down for Sam, New Jersey needs defense. And this is why I'm not surprised. Simon Nemec is a legitimate player. He's stout, he's robust, he's got great lateral movement, he makes a good first pass. He's played a ton of time against men. In the last 4 years, he's played in the Slovak big league. So the truth of the matter is, he's not a neophyte. He is a strong, big body player.
What I think you have to understand here is that when we look at this draft class, there's not a lot of separation between players. And so every general manager is going to say, all right, we're going to take the best player available. But when you have this situation where there's not a lot of separation, you can address a positional need. Jason, you talked a little bit about their center depth. They got Zach at the very back end. Then you got Heischer. Then you got Hughes. I mean, you have that position filled. So why not address something of one of your biggest needs? And that's exactly what New Jersey's done here.
This is an elite pick, guys. I mean, we're talking about a top two NHL defender on the horizon who's going to eat up even strength minutes. Run your power play. He's 100 or 200 pounds already. This kid might be close to NHL ready right now.
Absolutely agree. He is not that far from playing in the National Hockey League.
Let's head back down to the floor and Jeff Merrick.
Yeah, you know, the last draft, Dave, they took Luke Hughes, fourth overall defenseman there. Chase Thielman also went in the first round. He's a winger. He went 29th. The season before that, they had three first-rounders. Alexander Holtz goes seventh overall. Dawson Mercer, who's already in the NHL. The only question there is he a center or is he a winger? And then defense prospect Shakir Mukhamudulin. So this is a team very much, like you guys just mentioned, in search of cementing the future of that blue line. Hughes and Holtz are A-level prospects. Ethan Edwards at University of Michigan, he's a good depth defenseman for them as well, but as Pierre just mentioned, this is a very elite pick for the Devils.
It absolutely is, and if you didn't notice, he was also the MVP of the 2021 Hlinka Gretzky Cup. They call him a mobile D-man, a playmaker, and again, the number two overall pick. The Devils have their guy, and he's heading towards Carolyn Cameron, I believe, but a very exciting moment for him. Sam, you had some thoughts there.
Well, I think what's really cool about this situation is you go back to Canada playing against Slovakia at the Worlds. That was a 5-1 win for Canada. Nemitz had an assist in that, and after the game, one of the players, Canadian players, said, "Hey, we'll see you in the show next year, bud." That's how good he is.
Let's send it back to the floor, Carolyn Cameron.
Simon, the second overall pick to the New Jersey Devils, you're shaking your head. Did it surprise you?
Yeah. I was surprised because it was amazing for me and I think for Slovak hockey, first pick and second pick, amazing.
I mean, just months ago you stood next to your eye as you got your bronze medal at the Olympics. What does it mean to share this moment with him?
Ooh, I lost the words because I was surprised and... We were kids when we dream about NHL draft.
Well, you've been playing for the top league in Slovakia for 2 years away from home. How's that helped prepare you for the NHL?
I think it will be different. It will be different in ice and off ice, and I'm excited and we will see.
Congratulations.
Yeah,
best of luck.
Thank you. Thank you.
David?
All right. Thanks, Carolyn. Jason, let's get your scouting report.
Well, we're going to take a look at him handle a puck here that was wobbling. He's going to move to open ice. And this is what this kid does. He finds space on the offensive zone. But I want you to watch this play here very closely. He leads the rush. He's not only just quick on his own entry. That's a full-grown man in pro hockey. He's beating to the edge, getting pucks to the net. Here we are again, coming through the middle of the slot. Boom, here I am, burying a puck. That right there is going to be less of a natural thing that he does, but he's going to move it, and he's going to do a lot of other things.
All right, to Elliot.
Thanks, Dave. When did you make the decision on the Slovak defenseman?
Well, to be honest with you, this particular draft's been hard, you know, because of how good these kids are, potentially having the same upside but different positions. At the end of the day, we just felt right shot, puck moving, offensive-minded defenseman who actually takes pride in his own end was something we couldn't pass up.
Did you ever at all come close to moving the pick?
Yeah, I did. You know what? I guess if you're not trying to gain assets, then you're not trying hard enough to better your organization. But again, it was all because of the equalness, I guess we'll call it, consistency on one player to four players. So no, we're extremely happy.
Congratulations, Tom. Thank you.
Appreciate it,
Dave.
All right, Elliot. Again, a historic night. You said Bratislava, they're celebrating. My goodness, they're doubly celebrating now because not just the first pick, but the first two picks. And again, Marian Gaborik, all of 22 years ago, had been the highest pick out of Slovakia. But that record's been shattered not once, but twice tonight in what's been a pretty historic night. We still wait to see what's going to happen with Shane Wright. We still want to know what's happening with Logan Cooley, Matthew Savoy, Cutter Gauthier, etc. And we have Arizona coming up for the first of 10 picks that they have in this draft, Sam.
You know, it's really interesting what Arizona's doing. They've talked about taking on bad contracts. They're going to go to a smaller barn. Bill Armstrong has said he wants to rip this thing right down to the ground. He has done that, and now he has an opportunity to add another great piece here.
It's great to rip it down to the floor and everything else, but you still have to sell tickets.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things I'd be looking at is getting some exciting players in there. They all have Clayton Keller in there. I try to get some excitement
at least
there.
You only have to sell 5,000 now.
You know what, though? They got to sell them on the road, too. It's a worldwide game here, and you know, people want to buy tickets to see exciting teams, and this guy or the next pick, whatever they make, let's hope it's an exciting player.
Well, we'll wait and see. Xavier Gutierrez, the president and CEO for the Coyotes, as they set to make their pick. Again, Arizona, just one playoff appearance in the last 10 years. All sorts of trouble both on and off the ice for this franchise. Hopefully this could be a turning point for them as they look to add a foundational piece with this selection. Remember, last year they forfeited their first round pick for violating the combine testing rules. Let's hear from Xavier Gutierrez, president and CEO for the Coyotes, set to pick number 3 overall here in Montreal.
They got a deal on the suits.
Good to go. Bonjour. My name is Javier Gutierrez. I'm the president and CEO of the Arizona Coyotes. On behalf of owner Alex Morello, the Morello family, and the entire Arizona Coyotes organization, we'd like to thank the Montreal Canadiens and the great city of Montreal for your hospitality this week. We'd also like to congratulate the Colorado Avalanche on winning the Stanley Cup. Congrats. And we'd also like to share a moment of condolences to the family of Brian Marchmont and the San Jose Sharks organization. To our fans back in Arizona, many of whom are watching us at Wild Horse Pass Casino, thank you for your quarter century of support, loyalty, and dedication. To our corporate and community partners, thank you for being always part of the pack. To Arizona State University, we thank you for welcoming us into your family, and we look forward to playing in Tempe, Arizona. And to the city of Tempe, we look forward to our partnership in building an iconic sports and entertainment district. And with that, as we take our next step in our journey towards the Stanley Cup, I'd like to invite our GM, Bill Armstrong, to make our selection.
Arizona selects from the U.S. National Development Program, Logan Cooley.
Midland, Pennsylvania. Jason, you love this player.
He's the most electric forward in the draft. He's got the most upside to be an elite, elite scorer at the level. 1 year at Minnesota next year, playing under a really good coach and a fantastic program. Potential to win a national championship. NHL bound right after that.
Bob Motzko is that coach. He's an outstanding developer talent. He didn't just do it at Minnesota. He's also done it at St. Cloud State. Outstanding player. I think the biggest thing about Logan Cooley, he's going to make it fun to go to games in Arizona. I'll tell you that.
All right, let's send it down to Jeff Merrick.
You know, Logan Cooley's a fascinating center. When you look at Bill Armstrong and the Arizona Coyotes, at trade deadline, they picked up a couple of other centers. Jack McBain comes, or the rights to Jack McBain come over from the Minnesota Wild in exchange for a second rounder. Nathan Smith comes in from Winnipeg in the Brian Little deal, but they did need more down the middle. Last year, they took Dylan Gunther, ninth overall from the Edmonton Oil Kings. Also took Josh Doan, Shane Doan's son, in the second round as well. They have a real good prospect on the blue line of Victor Soderstrom, who played 20 games with the Coyotes, but very much this is what Arizona needs. He satisfies two needs, center position and exciting as well. Let's get to Kyle.
Well, Jeff, the word is around the U.S. program is that this is a guy that went from a boy to a man over the last 2 years. Talk to some of the trainers around their facility. They feel they don't know Logan Cooley very well because anytime they went to him to make a suggestion, some coaching about technique or form when they were in the gym, he learned right away. They didn't have to go talk to him again. And very much the same case on the ice. He is a quick learner. So not only are Arizona getting a very talented player, a very bright one as well. David?
All right. So there he is. Again, everyone uses the same words, dynamic, for Logan Cooley. In fact, Jason, you said you wouldn't have minded if he went first overall. He's that good. So Arizona has their first of 10 picks. Again, the big storyline, though, again, Shane Wright. You know, this guy, exceptional status, an exceptional player, CHL Rookie of the Year, has a 16-year-old, and he's still waiting. Your thoughts here, Sam?
Well, it's absolutely fascinating. You can see Shane, he's a little bit rattled by what's happened, too. But I can tell you something right now, that has already started to ignite his fire to prepare for the upcoming National Hockey League season. I'm looking forward to seeing what happens here.
Okay, we have a trade situation to announce. Let's hear what's happening on the floor.
You're losing some energy, but I have two trades to... I have... That's good. You want to hear the two trades? They involve the Canadians. Trade number one. Montreal Canadiens trade Alexander Romanov and pick number 98 in this year's draft to the New York Islanders in exchange for pick number 13 in this year's draft.
Wow. Romanov started to be a fan favorite here.
Montreal trades picks number 13 and 66 in this year's draft to the Chicago Blackhawks in exchange for Kirby Dach. the fourth selection in the 2022 NHL Draft, belongs to the Seattle Kraken. Seattle, you're on the clock.
Well, we promised you it was going to be unpredictable, and not one but two trades by the home team, the Montreal Canadiens. Essentially, they have a former third overall pick, Kirby Dach, coming to their team now. Romanov goes, as well as that number 13 pick they had acquired when they picked up Romanov. My head's ready to explode. What's your reaction here?
Well, you have to love it. I mean, this new management group, no problem. They've shown that, hey, we're going to go with what we want to do. We got Slafkovský. We need Kirby Dach. We're going to speed this thing up, and they're doing it.
Yeah, Jeff Gordon's been down that road before with the New York Rangers. But here's the one thing that I find very interesting about this. The New York Islanders get Romanov because they're probably not getting Zdeno Chara or Andy Green back. So they're filling with a top-end defenseman that's going to help them out. They also have to sign Noah Dobson. But the big thing is Kirby Dach now, he's a legitimate number two center to play behind Suzuki. That's big time. The Canadiens are proactive, and it's going to help the rebuild tremendously.
You have to score goals in the league, and they've just improved today their odds of scoring more goals. I'm a Romanov fan, though. Full disclosure, big, heavy defenseman. They don't make this trade, in my opinion, if they don't know that they've got guys like Keaton Gooley coming and, you know, some other college prospects on the horizon as well. If they're flush somewhere, they upgraded up front.
Yeah, I think Keaton Gooley, I think Justin Barron, all of a sudden you're seeing some of these young defensemen come to fruition. That opened up the streets.
Jaden Struble still on his way.
Jordan Harris is here. I mean, you're absolutely right.
And gentlemen, what has been the knock on the Habs all these years? They're too small up front. Well, they decided a beast in Slafkovský, 6'5". Kirby Dach is 6'5". Kind of overshadowed a very special moment, though, for Logan Cooley, the first American taken third overall. He has a new home in Arizona. He also has a place with our Carolyn Cameron. Carolyn.
Logan, your brother Eric, he gave you advice to soak in the moment. So how does this moment feel?
I mean, yeah, it's everything I dreamed of. You know, being able to be selected by, you know, such a great organization, such a bright team that has a bright future is really special. I'm glad to be part of the organization.
Highest pick ever out of Pittsburgh. I know you're probably thinking of a lot of people who got you here, but how much are you thinking of your hometown?
Yeah, I'm thinking about it a whole lot. I mean, you know, that's the reason I'm here today is because of all the people back home in Pittsburgh. They support me so much. And, you know, to be the highest pick is, you know, guys like JT Miller, Vincent Trocheck, John Gibbs, the list goes on. It's pretty special.
Well, Logan, congratulations and good luck.
Yeah, thank you so much.
David?
All right, Carolyn. Oh,
that's Logan Cooley getting ready for a little action there at the U.S. National Team Development Program. I got a great story for you, though. When this kid was 4 and 5 years old, Ray Shero, the general manager of the Pittsburgh Penguins, used to babysit him at the rink in Pittsburgh because Kyle and his brother Eric played together. So there would be Logan running around the rink, and Ray Shero used to be there as the manager of the Penguins, making sure the kid wasn't out of control.
Well, you mentioned Pittsburgh, and this is the latest of the line. And Pittsburgh's a hockey town. Talk to Colby Armstrong, who lives out that way. A lot of studs coming out of Pittsburgh, and the Logan Cooley is the latest to come from that hotbed of hockey in Pennsylvania. Can he be the keystone player for the Arizona Coyotes? That's the question. A lot of work to do in Arizona. And now we're waiting, of course, for the number 4 pick. And Ron Francis is ready to deliver that in a matter of moments. Last year, Seattle got Matty Beniers, a number 2 pick. He's been sensational, Sammy. They could add offense. They could add defense. Again, they didn't have a single player in the top 125 in scoring last year.
And it's crazy to think that they're sitting there at number 4. Are they going to trade the pick? What are they going to do? They can address a number of needs, as you mentioned. But I have to think, if you're sitting there and Shane Wright hasn't gone yet, you'd be hard-pressed to pass him by in this spot. And here he is.
The fourth selection, the Seattle Kraken are proud to select from the Kingston Frontenacs, Shane Wright.
Congratulations to Shane Wright. I'm sure some relief and some happiness as well going to Seattle. He has his NHL home. Again, an exceptional career in junior hockey, and now he's off to Seattle. Longer wait than he expected, but what does he bring them?
Well, he just brings them that 200-foot game. He brings them everything. The ability to score, to make players around him better. He's responsible in his own zone. He's a right shot guy. He wins faceoffs. He does just about everything that is required to get to a Stanley Cup, you need these type of players. And while he might not provide the same type of offense might you get from Logan Cooley or Juraj Slafkovský, it's super important to have that guy who can play in every situation for you. And Shane can do that.
The chief scout of the Seattle Kraken is Robert Cron. I coach Robert Cron. He's a fantastic 200-foot player. But the general manager of the Seattle Kraken, I also had the privilege of coaching, one of the best 200-foot players that ever played in the National Hockey League. So these guys know exactly what they drafted, Sam, and I think this is a perfect pick for where they are as an organization, Jason.
Special moment for their family, their dad Simon, mom Tanya, his sister Maddie as well. Great moment for the Wright family. He's off to Seattle, Jeff.
You know, for general manager Ron Francis, I think Pierre really nailed it. Look at this, a 200-foot player drafted by one of the best 200-foot players the game has ever seen. What we know about Seattle is they need to build and stock their prospect cupboards. They're looking for everything. There was a belief that the player they coveted was Simon Nemec. He went second overall to the New Jersey Devils. But look at this view. Ron Francis and Shane Wright. Matt Beniers will be a full-time NHLer next season. They drafted Matty Beniers second overall. 9 points in 10 NHL games. That guy is legit. And think about this, guys. For the next 10 years of Seattle Kraken hockey, you're going to see Matty Beniers, and when he joins the NHL, and that is a question too, you're going to have Matty Beniers and Shane Wright right up the middle. Prospect depth is something they need to fill out. Riker Evans on the back end, second round pick in 2021 for the Regina Pats. Petro Sapala signed, not drafted out of league as a couple on the back end, but this is a really nice bit of business that Ron Francis just did. Shane Wright standing by with Carolyn Cameron.
Shane, with all the expectation and the speculation headed into this draft, how does it feel now to know where you're calling home in the NHL?
Feels incredible. It's such an honor. Such an honor to be drafted by an incredible franchise. Obviously, it's the new franchise, the NHL, and they got a lot of positive outcomes, a lot of positive prospects coming through the system, and really excited to be a part of it. Really excited to be a Seattle Kraken, and couldn't be happier.
You told me at the combine that with the pressure leading up to this draft year, that it was a year of personal growth for you. How so?
Yeah, I think I definitely learned a lot about myself, just about my resiliency, responding to adversity. Obviously had a lot of adversity during the pandemic and the COVID year, and then obviously this year as well, a lot of expectations, a lot of pressure. So just proud of myself for the way I handle everything, really proud of myself for growing as a person, and happy with how everything turned out.
Well, congratulations and good luck in Seattle. Here's Elliot Friedman with your new GM.
I was making a joke with Ron Francis, two-way center out of the Ontario Hockey League, and you made a good point, pick number four for both of you.
Yeah, it was pick number four. I think anytime you're starting a franchise, you're looking to get centermen. It's really hard to get, and to get a guy of Shane's quality, we're really excited to bring him into our family.
You always wonder, you sort of dial it out and say what could happen. Did you see the possibility that Wright could be here today?
Yeah, actually, we played it out a few different ways, and we thought this could be a possibility, something we're excited if it was going to happen, and we're excited that it did happen for us.
Thanks very much, Ron. Congratulations.
Thanks, Ellie. Appreciate it.
Dave?
All right, and Sam, this is the elite group he's a part of.
And the OHL didn't play at all last year. So you look at the exceptional players that have come before him where they've had that additional year, and the number of games played, Shane Wright, significantly less than everybody else. And I think that's something that's really gone underappreciated here, the fact that he's missed his draft minus one developmental year. It's absolutely huge. Yes, you can go and work out. Yes, you can get on the ice and do skills and all those things, but missing games is key. And I think I harken back to the under-18s where he's absolutely brilliant. And think about his game, the details in his game. All right, high defensive zone, make an interception, get it back going the other way. Eyes in the back of my head. I know there's a trailer there. No problem. Let's get it over and make an easy goal here. Shane Wright, yeah, I see a lot of different options, but the best one here is for me to shoot the puck. I think when he's at his best, which was at that under-18s, he makes everyone else around him better. And one thing I'll say about this pick for Seattle, they have a lot of former head scouts in their staff. Robert Cron, you talked about. Darren Yoff was in Minnesota. Mike Dawson was with Carolina as well. So was Chris McDonald with Vancouver. Those two guys are based in Kingston. So they would have seen everything of Shane Wright going back to his 16-year-old year, but there are a lot of good things there, and going back to this past year with the Kingston Frontenacs.
Absolutely. That's a really good point, by the way. You can't have enough information. And they probably watched a lot of practices, too.
You know, any extra viewings you can get, especially in these odd times, bring value. So that's a very, very strong possibility.
So Shane Wright has a home in Seattle. Again, they're going to love his offense. They're going to love his leadership more than anything else. You heard Ron Francis say that. We liked him as much as a person as we do as a player. So he has a new home. We're rolling towards Philadelphia, who has the fifth overall pick. And there's plenty of different picks to choose from, but there is Shane Wright. We'll be hearing from him in a matter of moments as well.
So much character with this young man. And I go back to the OHL Cup, which is the minor hockey. Don Mills Flyers, they won the OHL Cup. He was the GTHL Player of the Year as an underager. And at 14, he was talking like he's a guy who was 20 years old. And talked to the Montreal Canadiens. They met him on six different occasions. They tried to find something wrong with his character. It was impossible to find everywhere he's been.
All right, let's enter to the podium. Chuck Fletcher, President of Hockey Ops and the GM.
Philadelphia Flyers would like to welcome Jasmine Martinez from Ed Snyder Youth Hockey and Education to make our first pick.
Hello. With the fifth overall pick, the Philadelphia Flyers are proud to pick Cutter Gauthier.
A special hug, of course, with his father, Sean, who was picked in the ninth round by the Winnipeg Jets back in 1991. Cutter Gauthier, a left wing, who's committed to BC next year. And he can play wing or center, probably a big attraction to the Flyers.
Well, the fact that he's come out recently and admitted that he's going to probably move to the center ice position at BC, that was a game changer coming out of the combine. Good information that BC plans to play him there as well. This kid has the quickest release in the draft. He's ambidextrous. He shared that with us at the combine as well. In tight quarters, when he gets it, it's off his stick quickly. Another big body who can box opponents out, so he doesn't need a lot of space to score goals. If he plays the center ice position and he's got speed off the rush with size, this is a really solid pick for Philly, something to build around.
I already spoke to Mike Ayers, who's the assistant coach that recruited him out of the U.S. National Team Development Program. He is definitely playing center. He's not playing the wing. They already told Cutter Gauthier that. The interesting thing, we saw Cutter Gauthier's father, Sam. His father played with Greg Brown in Leksand, Sweden as professionals. Greg Brown's the new head coach at Boston College.
Isn't that something? You have all these different connections, but if you just take a step back and you're looking at it from a big picture, what do you think about when you think about the Philadelphia Flyers? Big, heavy, tough to play against, yet can still score just as easily as they punch you in the mouth. And then they Cutter Gauthier is that guy. He fits the Flyers bill perfectly.
And what a road to the stage, hey? Born in Sweden, raised in Arizona. And again, one of those studs on the U.S. National Team Development Program. Again, a lot of excitement surrounding that U.S. team and the prospects that they're bringing into the National Hockey League.
To be fair, though, this player's not ready to play in the National Hockey League right now. He needs time and going to Boston College. By the way, for those that are listening in Kitchener, his OHL rights are owned by the Kitchener Rangers. So don't think Mike McKenzie, the general manager, they're not going to try to get him not to go to B.C.
All right, so the top five picks are in, and what a moment for Jure Slafkovský. Out of Slovakia, goes first to Montreal. Semin Nemeth, the second to New Jersey. And Logan Cooley, hugs all around, going to Arizona. Much more coming up. Keep it locked here. You're watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft on Sportsnet.
Welcome back inside here in Montreal, and you are now a member of the Philadelphia Flyers. Yeah. Do you already like orange?
I do. I've been a fan ever since I was a kid. You know, my mom grew up in Philly, so it's a huge honor to be drafted by such a great organization.
Well, and she gave you the big hug. I think you have the biggest crowd here, 100 friends and family, and I want to show you something that I know your mom helped you with in terms of trying to motivate you for your career. When you see all these quotes, what comes to mind?
Yeah, you know, it takes a whole village to get to the next level and get to the NHL. And, you know, my family and my friends, you know, they're all part of the process and they helped me get to this next level. So if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be where I am today.
Before the break, we mentioned how you're ambidextrous, too. I'm curious to know how it helps you in hockey, but we saw at the combine it helps you with juggling.
Yeah, I don't think it helps me too much on the ice, but it's just a fun thing to have in my sleeve. So it's always fun messing around right-handed, so it's always a great time.
Well, congratulations. Good luck at Boston College and Philadelphia.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
You gotta love the smiles on their faces, realizing their dreams. It's such a special moment, and yeah, he is a pretty good juggler as well. Columbus, they have both the 6th and the 12th pick as they make their way onto the stage. A lot of speculation, so many different additions that they could use on this team. And it's gonna be John Davidson, the president of Hockey Ops for Columbus, to announce what's happening with the team. Any speculation here?
I just like that they have a young team, and to continue to keep both these picks I think would be wise, as I like the direction they're going.
They need defense. Remember, Seth Jones was traded out of there. They're doing a lot with Brad Lorenzky, Zach Lorenzky. They need defense there.
Bonjour. Merci beaucoup, à la belle ville Montreal. Yes, you have a beautiful city. Thank you very much to the Molson family for putting on and hosting a great time. We would like to say hello to our fans at Pins Easton. Thank you very much, Fifth Line, for being great supporters. With our first pick, I would like to introduce our general manager, Jarmo Kekäläinen.
With the sixth overall pick, the Columbus Blue Jackets are proud to select from Czech Pilsen David Jiříček.
Fantastic emotion there with David Jiříček, the Chechnyan, Chechia. Did I say that right?
Czechia,
there we go. Right-handed D-man, as you alluded to, Pierre, they do go with a D-man. Jason, your thoughts on this selection?
Big, tall, lean, right-shot defenseman. These guys are a commodity when they become pros. He's not a one-trick pony. He can do things offensively. For his reach and his length in his game, he makes plays close to his body. I call him pocket plays. So he's elusive in tight areas. He can walk the line in the offensive zone. He's got a big shot. His balance and his strength, his core strength, has a long way to go to be an NHL-ready defenseman. But this is a sound pick in this slot.
Sam, I have a question for you. He had knee surgery this year. How has he come out of that?
Well, I think he came out of it at the end of the year. He's able to get into some games and actually played five of the 10 games that Czechia played in the men's worlds. That was hugely important for his confidence and knowing just what it's going to take to move forward. And you talk about building that strength, that's going to be huge to avoid future injuries.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the thing. He needs more volume, right? And is it going to take place over in Europe again next year? Or is this a player that we'll see in North America to further his development? Time will tell.
Probably not ready to play in the NHL just yet, but a guy especially coming off a year where he had that knee injury, happened against Canada at the World Juniors. Great to see him come back and apply himself, though, in the men's world.
All right, Jeff.
So last year at the draft, an absolute bonanza for the Columbus Blue Jackets and their general manager, Jarmo Kekäläinen, Ken Johnson and Cole Sillinger. Now Ken Johnson is a legit pro. That's 1-2 for that team. So they're set up for the next 10 years essentially down the middle. In 2020, Kekäläinen shocked everybody, taking Yegor Chinnikov, who ended up playing 62 games this season. But we wondered about the back end. Carson Kuhlman's top prospect on the back end, along with Samuel Konashko from the Seattle Thunderbirds. Now, as much as we think they may need to shore up a complement with more scoring forwards, now they're really starting to shore up that back end, guys. Jiříček now becomes the number one prospect on the blue line for the Columbus Blue Jackets. Period.
And he says his favorite tennis player is Rafael Nadal, so he's gone through some injury woes. He had to drop out of Wimbledon today. But as you mentioned, he had that knee surgery in January after the World Juniors, but so much skill, so much possibilities with this selection.
Yeah, what I like about him is that there's some comparisons to Moritz Seider. Now, he's not as strong as Moritz was at that time in his career, but the ability to kill plays, play with some physicality, and yet add some offensive production are all parts of what we saw from the Calder Trophy winner in Detroit.
100%, and I agree. I'm going to throw another comparable out there. Once he gets that core strength that Jason was talking about, don't be surprised if there's a little Ryan McDonagh in him. A lot of similarities to McDonagh to see him.
Wow, and Ryan McDonagh was on the move to Nashville in a trade that happened earlier. If you're just tuning in, the Montreal Canadiens have already made two trades on this evening, including picking up Kirby Dach from Chicago. Chicago's going to be on the board in a matter of moments. But first, down to Carolyn Cameron.
Well, David, it's been a draft year unlike any other, with the pandemic and injury for you in December that led to surgery. That being said, after the last 7 months, how satisfying is this moment?
That's incredible. That's incredible because I have a very good friend with Stanislav Svozil, so he's from Czech, and very good organization, so for me it's awesome.
Well, and at the World Championships, you were teammates with the likes of David Krejci, David Pasternak. Yes. Did either of them give you any solid advice heading into the draft?
Yeah, they said to me on the ice, not on the draft, don't be afraid. So I was not afraid there, so I'm very happy.
Well, congratulations and best of luck in Columbus.
Thank you very much.
Let's take a look at what Columbus is getting in David Jiříček here. You're going to see him on the... This is what I'm talking about, pocket plays, like tight area game where he can wait for a defender to approach him before making a play. Here's a bomb from the middle of the ice. Pro goal. Nobody's going to stop that from that type of area. Here's where I'm talking about his balance. If you saw there, there's a little bit of a hiccup when he's trying to defend on the outside. Core strength, a little bit more agility is going to improve that. Again, scoring from range. Two different goals in these clips. One from deeper in the slot, one from longer range, beating goaltenders clean.
And the last Czech player taken in the first round was Filip Zadina back in 2018. And as far as highest drafted defensemen go, of course, Roman Hamrlík went first overall to the Lightning in 92. But look where he slots in. A pretty good group of defensemen right there. And David Jiříček, number sixth overall this year.
It's really cool. He was talking a little bit about Stanislav Svozil, who was taken by Columbus in the third round last year. He plays for the Regina Pats. They're good buddies. And anytime you get a situation where you can walk into a room or a camp and feel more comfortable, that's hugely beneficial to the player.
No question about it. Because when he goes to the development camp next week, he says, there's my buddy.
Yeah, and it's nice and comfortable for him.
One of the coolest things that happens in live drafts, guys, if we see the replay tonight, he was crying on stage and kissed the logo of the jersey on his way off. What an awesome
That's
moment
cool.
in the first round.
That's
32
really
dreams
cool.
coming true tonight. If you're wondering why I have the stigma, we had a few audio issues. Maybe the lisp is gone now, and hopefully you can hear me loud and clear. It's been a lot of fun for many teams active so far, including Chicago. They didn't have any draft picks in the first round because they had traded the sixth overall pick, essentially, what ended up being the sixth overall pick for Seth Jones in that deal last year. Now they have two first-round picks because they made this deal with Montreal and another deal, in case you missed it, Alex DeBrincat going to the Ottawa Senators for now the seventh pick. So we're going to hear from Kyle Davidson, the Hawks GM, as Chicago gets ready to make the first of two first-round picks here at the 2022 NHL Entry Draft.
Merci, Montréal, pour votre accueil.
Thank you, Montreal, for the fantastic week. And a special thank you to all the amazing fans here today who make this such a special event. We'd like to say hello to all of our fans back in Chicago, and specifically the Highland Park residents. Our hearts are with you. With the seventh overall pick, the Chicago Blackhawks are proud to select from the Seattle Thunderbirds, Kevin Korchinski.
Well, Sam, it looks like we have a little run on defensemen here as Kevin Korchinski out of the WHL in Seattle, 6'2", 185 pounds from Saskatoon. Congratulations to him. Your thoughts?
What a huge rise to prominence for this young man playing for Matt Odette, who will have a couple more of his players selected, maybe even one more tonight, but for sure a couple tomorrow. And this is a guy who had 61 assists, third in all of the WHL, 65 points in total. And it's the offensive instincts that you really have to like. He's got a bomb of a shot as he's put on display there. Works well with the one-timer. He's not afraid to be part of the rush. Really good in the transition game. I love his ability to be able to walk the blue line. And you see here, takes a little step back, buys himself a little space. That excellent shot really working well. And I like this piece of business by Kyle Davidson, because you're a new general manager, you go out, you get two first-round picks, you identify Korchinski as your guy, but you make sure you get high enough to be able to ensure that you get him. So, really gutsy move here by some new general managers in their first time on the job.
I remember a defenseman playing in Seattle by the name of Shea Theodore.
Yes.
This guy reminds me a lot of Shea Theodore, who's just ripping it up with the Vegas Golden Knights. And the big thing about him, if you're into analytics, you're going to love this player because he's an analytic darling. His exits and his entries are phenomenal.
And his father, Larry, played in the WHL back in the 80s, and a massive jump for him over the last 2 months. Let's get down to the floor and hear from Kyle.
All right, David. Well, Sam mentioned earlier Matt Odette, the head coach in Seattle. He's the one who talked about over the 12 to 18 months of Korchinski in Seattle. He went from 5'10" to 6'2". The head coach and his staff often come into the building around 7 a.m. and already at that time they hear the thud, thud, thud of the shooting tarp. That was Kevin Korchinski putting in the work early and often. And he feels as he has grown, he's actually grown into his skating stride, a little bit of a knee-knocking stride early on. Now that he's lengthened out, it's a more smoother stride and a more powerful stride now headed to Chicago, David.
Well, I'd just like to add that you look at that Chicago staff, Brian Campbell, Norm McIver, the new head coach, Luke Richardson. The conversations in that draft room, the war room, had to revolve around prioritizing this player.
Love that moment, too. The parents, everyone is so proud. Let's send it down to Carolyn.
Kevin, what's your reaction just seeing your family there?
Yeah, it's crazy. Obviously, being here with them, it's amazing. It's awesome. It's the people you do this for. So getting to celebrate with them this moment, it's phenomenal.
You weren't able to be at the combine, so you had to do a lot of virtual meetings. Did you have a sense that Chicago was pretty interested?
Yeah, I knew they interested. I didn't do any, interviews here, but I knew interested just talking to them throughout the year. So obviously, I was a Chicago Blackhawks fan. I was a kid, all those cups. So it's really special.
Did they ask you to play piano in the Zoom interview or no?
No, okay. They didn't. Yeah.
Maybe so. Now you'll have to play for them regardless. Now. Well, congratulations and best of luck.
Awesome. Thank you.
Carolyn has all the little tidbits. I love it. So he's a big piano player. And look at this, guys. I mean, this is really impressive. Most assists by a WHL rookie defenseman since 1983, and he leads the list. I mean, this is a great facilitator. We see guys like Provorov in the league right now and the Jones brothers. That speaks volumes to why they wanted to pick this guy so high.
It's so important to have that puck moving from the back end to make a good decision, whether it's the first pass. You talked about being an analytics darling, Pierre, in terms of his exits and clean entries. So important in today's game. You need to have the puck. You need to manage it properly. Korchinski does a pretty good job of that. I think at some point they'd like to see him work a little bit more on the defensive side of his game, but when you talk about the mentors that you did, Jason, it shouldn't be a problem getting that part sorted out.
No, there's going to be a lot of player development assistance with this player. When we look at that clip, I'm looking for him to start shooting the puck a little bit more as well, because he's a proficient puck mover. Let's see him start releasing that bomb from range a little bit more as a pro.
Yeah, interesting you say that, because it's just the four goals this year, and I think we had them all in that pack.
That's right.
So Kevin Korchinski goes again out of Saskatoon and the WHL with Seattle. Before we get to Detroit's pick at 8, and that's going to be in about a minute here, really, Pierre, I just wanted a quick thought on what's been the biggest sort of takeaway 7 picks into this draft?
That it's chaotic, a lot of calamity, a lot of good players, but now it's going to go off the rails. Watch. Going to be crazy.
All right, well, let's hear from the Chicago Blackhawks GM, Kyle Davidson, who's standing by with Elliot. He's been in the front and center of everything, Elliot.
Yeah, Dave, no bigger newsmaker today than Kyle Davidson. The two deals you've made, Doc and DeBrincat. I think the one thing we're all wondering about DeBrincat is, could you have waited? Why did you feel the need to do it now?
It's tough moving an Alex DeBrincat. He's such a good player. But where we are in our rebuild, I think it was essential that we got into the top 10 tonight and got a really quality player. And, you know, I know a lot of people say this, but we got our guy. We did this with the intention of getting Kevin Korchinski in the first round. And so, you know, I think to that effect, we were really happy with it. But again, it doesn't make it easy to move on from a guy like Alex DeBrincat.
I think the thing we're all kind of wondering now is just Taves and Kane, Seth Jones, you said the guys with the no-move clauses are not available. Has that changed at all?
The way we're operating is remaining the same. It's you know what, we're going to keep them abreast of what's going on. We're going to keep them posted, but we're not approaching them on anything, and so we're just going to continue to listen on other players. But the players with the no move clauses are the ones that are going to stick around for
Marco
a bit.
Kaspar.
And that was Marco Kasper, taken 8th by Detroit. Steve Yzerman making the announcement, the center out of Austria. Someone who's intrigued a lot of different people in the NHL community. I've heard all three of you talk about him offset. What intrigues you most about him, Jason?
Well, 200-foot game. He's another guy that can play the wing and center ice. And what he did is only grow exponentially as the season got harder. His best hockey was played in the playoffs. He's had a great program coming out of Rogla. The Abbott brothers there have developed him. And this is a responsible player that I don't know that his ceiling is a top six forward. He's definitely a 3F, like a high-end 3F that can do a lot of different things. He's a little bit of a Swiss Army knife secondary scorer.
You know, what's fascinating to me is that this guy has had such a drive to get to this point. At 16 years old, he leaves Austria. He goes to Sweden. He learns the language in 3 months. He decides that, yeah, you know what, I'm still going to go to school while I'm playing in the SHL, the NHL equivalent over there. So he's sitting beside guys in high school, yet, oh, yeah, I got to go on a road trip here. Sorry, boys, I got to go. So you have to love the fact that he's learned to cook, clean, do everything on his own from the age of 16 in an entirely different country. My goodness, if I think about my children and how it'd be so tough to separate from them to do that. Yet this guy had all the will to do it. His parents gave him the leeway to do it, and it's culminated in being picked 8th overall.
Detroit's starting to build up some big kind of status in terms of forwards that can be physical. Carter Mazur, University of Denver, and now they add Casper, who's a real physical guy. It's going to be exciting to be a Red Wings fan again.
Let's get to Jeff Merrick.
This is such a Steve Yzerman pick as the rebuild continues. You know, they have the Rookie of the Year in Moritz Seider, Lucas Raymond, a future star. We know the general manager, Steve Yzerman, is patient. Last year at the draft, it was Simon Edvinson, 6th overall, the defenseman we expect to play on the wings this season. Sebastian Cossé, you identify the goaltending, the Oil Kings. He goes 15th overall. The thing about the Wings is they have a very high-end talent with their prospect pool. You look up front, Jonathan Bergwin, Theodore Niederbach, Elmer Soderblom. But what they need is, as someone from another team just texted me, someone who will go through a wall to win. Lots of teams were high on Marco Casper. The Detroit Red Wings were the ones that got him. And he brings an element that few, if any other players in this draft can bring. This is another hit pick from the Red Wings. There's a lot of disappointed general managers on this floor right now that didn't get Marco Casper. Let's hear from him and Carolyn Canlon.
As he gets set up here with his mic, and Marco, I know you don't have your driver's license yet in Austria, so you always bike to the rink. Have you imagined yet what it'll be like biking to the rink in Detroit?
I haven't imagined yet, but I'm just thankful to be picked by such a great franchise, such great players in the past, and it's truly an honor. And I'm thankful to my family too, and my past teams, especially Rögle and Klagenfurt too, and also my agent. So it's awesome feeling.
Okay, what's more nerve-wracking then? Waiting in the seat for your name to be called, or perhaps starring in an Austrian film?
I mean, I was really young when I was in that film, so it was pretty nerve-wracking, you know, being here. But it's just a fun experience, and so cool.
Maybe some foreshadowing, too, because you were wearing the red and white, and now you're donning the red and white for Detroit.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
All right, Carolyn, maybe no surprise, because for a fifth straight year, the Detroit Red Wings select a European player with their first overall pick. They've missed the playoffs the last 6 years, Sam.
It's interesting you say that, David, because when you look at Steve Yzerman's career and think about the players he played with, whether it was Datsyuk from Russia, Zetterberg from Sweden, or Lidstrom from Sweden, now he's doing the same thing. Talk about Raymond from Sweden, Seider from Germany, Casper from Austria. That multinational group coming together for Steve Yzerman is something that he had experience with a player and now doing it as a general manager.
Don't forget Simon Edvinson, too. That guy's legit big time good. He's coming to Detroit. He's 6'4" defenseman that plays on the left side. Håkan Andersson is the key. Håkan Andersson is a phenomenal scout for the Red Wings. He's been there almost 30 years. He's the key to getting those Swedish players.
Jason, let's get your Marco Casper scouting pack.
Well, we're going to take a look at Casper here, coming off the wall, shielding the puck. He can go to open space because he's a big enough body that he can shield people. Gets it to the net, quick release. Down below the goal line, again, that's an agility. Like that play right there, when he can spin off a check, take it to the paint, make a play. How about out front the net? Let's just do a little bit of this and that, a little JVR in his game, down low around the net for a quick tuck. This kid is going to be hard to play against in hard areas, and he's going to score some goals, but be responsible everywhere else on the ice.
He's got more of a North American presence than a lot of kids that are coming out of that league right now, and a lot of that's because how physical he is.
Yeah, you don't sleep on Steve Yzerman. He was a big part of the architect. Julian Brisebois has done an incredible role and taking him to the finish line in Tampa, but Steve Yzerman built a lot of what we saw Tampa and their back-to-back Stanley Cup championships. So we get Detroit has their men and Marco Casper, and maybe the envy of many other teams as you see Shane Doan yucking it up with them right there. And next on the board is the Buffalo Sabres. They actually have three first-round picks at 9, 16, and 28, and no one, and I mean no one, needs to do a better job at this draft than this man, Kevyn Adams, because again, they've missed the playoffs 11 straight years.
I got to trust what he's done so far. I thought he did brilliant work in the Jack Eichel trade. He waited patiently for it to make it happen, got the guys he wanted, got guys that want to be in Buffalo. That's also a key element of what he's done so far. And he has just grown up through the ranks there, whether it was running Harbor Center and their minor hockey program and their academy. An excellent job here, now the general manager.
All right, so Buffalo on the clock and Kevyn Adams to the podium. Let's hear what the Sabres do.
The Buffalo Sabres are proud to select from Winnipeg in the Western Hockey League, Matthew Savoy.
And he follows his brother Carter to the NHL. Carter, of course, drafted with the fourth round pick by Edmonton a couple of years ago. Now, he had a shoulder injury in the WHL playoffs, but the one word I keep hearing whenever I've read anything about this guy, Matthew Savoy, is dynamic. Is that fair?
He just pops. When he's out on the ice, and JB, you and I were at the CHL Top Prospects game, and every time he was out there, he was noticeable. He's got that great skating ability. He's got a good lower center of gravity. Some people would have been concerned about that size, but he's got that wide hockey frame, and so he's got a good solid foundation. He passes it like a pro. Watching him pass is like watching an NHL game. And maybe the underrated part of this game is his ability to shoot the puck. You talk to his teammates, Connor Geek, Connor McLennan, oh yeah, this guy can really shoot the puck as well.
They're getting an array of forwards in Buffalo now. Tage Thompson, Jack Quinn, J.J. Paterka, Peyton Krebs, Casey Mittelstadt, Alex Tuck, Dylan Cousins. They are building an arsenal of forward power in Buffalo that is pretty scary.
Absolutely. This kid has Braden Point upside. That's how good he is. I mean, he is electric off the rush. This is the type of player that sells tickets. He's going to bring people out of their seats in Buffalo. He's a dynamic offensive talent.
There he is, the newest member of the Buffalo Sabres. And a smaller player, right? 5'9", 170. But again, the comparisons you guys just mentioned, incredible comparisons. And it's all about skill now in the league, not so much size.
Yeah, and the thing about Savoy is he was given concessions by the Western Hockey League to play 21 games as a 15-year-old. That really never happens. He wasn't granted exceptional status, but still made those concessions. And so he comes back the next year to Winnipeg. They're not sure if they're going to start. He makes a move to the USHL right away. Puts up 21 goals, 38 points in 34 games. And I think that was hugely key for his development because he got to play most of the year in his draft minus 1 year when a lot of guys didn't get that sort of regularity. Then he comes back to Winnipeg. 90 points this year is really telltale of what I think he can be in the future.
I worked with Tyler Ennis this year in Ottawa, and I will tell you one thing. Tyler Ennis says, I work out with this kid, Matt Savoy. He says, man, oh man, is he intense. Buffalo, buckle up.
Well, they have to be enjoying that in St. Albert, Alberta. Matthew Savoy, the ninth overall pick. 9 down, 23 to go. Youth will be served. We'll be seeing these guys on video games soon enough. You're watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal on Sportsnet, hydrated by BioSteel.
Celebrate the NHL Draft with a free digital trading card set. Collect today by scanning the QR code exclusively on upperdeckepac.com.
Welcome back to the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal. We're awaiting a pick from Anaheim, but first we got to hear from the newest member of the Buffalo Sabres, Matthew Savoy, standing by with our Carolyn Cameron. Carolyn.
Well, Matt, you grew up an Oilers fan. I know you watched ecstatically when Connor McDavid was selected first overall. How does this experience compare with what you saw on TV?
Yeah, it's been a blast, the whole experience so far. Just pure excitement for me and ready to get to work in Buffalo.
You're so close with your family. You talk to them every day. What does it mean to you to share this moment with them and also the memory of your late grandpa Don around your neck?
Yeah, definitely. The family's been my biggest supporters growing up, and to have them here in Montreal going through the whole experience together, it's really been a blessing, and I can't thank them enough.
I know that necklace underneath is a lucky charm. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
All right, Carolyn, we're now awaiting Anaheim, who will have two picks in the first round as well, 10th and 22nd. They got the 22nd pick in that Hampus-Lindholm trade with the Boston Bruins. And really quickly, because we see Pat Verbeek's taking the stage, thoughts on Anaheim?
Well, an entirely new organization now with Pat Verbeek there. He's learned from some of the best, and Steve Yzerman and Julien Brisebois. Now he gets to put his stamp with his first pick here.
The Anaheim Ducks would like to wish Kim Marchment, the Marchment family, and the entire the San Jose Sharks our warmest sympathies. With the 10 selection, the Anaheim Ducks select Pavel Mintikov from the Saginaw Spirit.
Yeah,
And there it is, Pavel Minchukov, the fourth defenseman taken so far in the draft in the first 10 picks. And Anaheim, remember, they lost Lindholm in a trade. They also lost to Colorado.
Josh Manson.
So they're trying to rebuild that blue line starting here.
This is a pretty cool situation, I got to tell you. So this guy is a hockey junkie. And then he's talking to his coach, Chris Lazary, there in Saginaw. And Chris says, hey, where do you want to go? Like, what team do you like? And he says, well, I've picked out a few teams. And he says, well, why is that? And I'm not going to say which one. He said, well, I've kind of looked through all their prospect lists, and I think this is going to be my fastest path to get to the NHL by these certain teams. And now I have to think that Anaheim might be on that list, because you look at them losing the two defensemen that you referenced there, David. Yeah, you think about Cam Fowler. He's starting to get up there in age a little bit. You think about Jamie Drysdale. He's up and coming. Well, this guy now might have an opportunity to jump here pretty quickly. I'm not saying right away. I think there's a lot of development left in his game, but pretty cool how he's such a hockey junkie, and I just wonder if Anaheim was on that list of teams.
He's a great power play player. He's a great first pass defenseman. The big thing to me is with Jamie Drysdale, they just got Drew Helison in the Josh Manson trade, and they got two prospects at Harvard in Ian Moore and also Henry Thrun. But you're right, that would be a quick track, I think, in Anaheim for him just because of the lack of depth in defense.
All right, so the first of two picks for Anaheim in the first round, and he was third in the OHL with points from a D-man, so they got an offensive-minded defenseman. And again, we have everything covered here on site, as does Steve Dangle and Colby Armstrong. They're live from the draft. They're streaming on YouTube with a different twist on things. They're bringing you guests, immediate reaction, in a way only Colby Armstrong and Steve Dangle can. All the goods coming your way. And again, they're hydrated by BioSteel, as they call it, the draft class. All right, so we're 10 picks in, guys. What has caught your eye mostly, Sam, here?
Well, we talk about Pavel Minchukov, and one of the things that we discussed leading up to this draft is what is going to be the plight of these Russian players. And so we've talked a little bit about Danila Yurov. We've talked about Ivan Mirochnichenko. And now when you have Minchukov, here's a guy that has been parked in Saginaw, and the guy who, excellent on the power play, but of Russian descent, but he's been over here. So I think it's a little bit easier to maintain his status while already being over here, as opposed to having to be a player who comes over from Russia and wondering if that will ever happen. And I think Anaheim did its due diligence, pretty confident that with him being here, he's going to be able to stay here. But a guy who likes to rush the puck, really good around the line, he's got forward-like hands. And that's pretty cool to have from a defenseman, because you can use those same things to help defend.
Sorry to interrupt you. Commissioner Gary Bettman has a trade to announce.
I'd like to announce a trade. That's better. The Arizona Coyotes trade pick number 11, the next pick in this draft, to the San Jose Sharks for picks 27, 34, and 45 in the 2022 draft. That means San Jose has the 11th selection in the 2022 draft. And San Jose, you're on the clock.
All right, I hate to correct the commissioner here, but I think San Jose traded the 11th pick to Arizona for those three draft picks. And you saw Mike Greer, who's the newly minted GM for San Jose. So I believe it's actually, unless we have this back, it's Arizona that's on the clock, not San Jose.
Yeah, and I think they're trying to discuss the confusion and make sure that that's not the case.
All right, now let's send it down to the floor to Elliot Friedman. Elliot.
First draft pick is Anaheim GM for Pat Verbeek. And Pat, one of the big questions was about Russian players. If he wasn't playing in Saginaw, would you have done this?
Yeah, the talent is undeniable. So we're looking for the best hockey players. We're looking, you know, to get our franchise going in the right direction, you know, towards winning the Stanley Cup, and we think this player is going to really help us get there.
Have things unfolded tonight as you expected, or have you even been surprised by what we've seen?
I think unfolded, there's been a couple surprises, maybe on some of the teams and how they selected, but other than that, I think it's looking pretty close to how, you know, we had it.
Thanks very much, Pat.
Yeah, thanks.
Dave?
All right, and just to clarify, yes, it's Arizona that's coming back to make the 11th pick. They're the ones who traded to get the 11th pick from San Jose. I can tell you Arizona already has Logan Cooley at the 3 pick, and now they go and they trade 3 picks to move up to that 11. You like what they're seeing there from them?
Absolutely. They're trying to get aggressive, and they're trying to make their team fun again and be relevant, because at the end of this year, their team was not relevant at all, and they got to get relevant in a hurry.
I think this is the draft to be doing this type of a trade or initiating this type of aggression. Three picks out, one pick in, get the guys you really want at the high end of this draft. That's the best way. Real good strategy here.
That's the crazy part about this draft. Because there's no discernible ledges, everyone's list looks entirely different. So one list might have a guy at 30, but another team might have him at 15. And so, as you mentioned, Jason, before, trade back scenarios are probably going to present themselves, and we're seeing that with San Jose. And I don't think we've seen the last of it.
No, and I got to think that Arizona's looking at it either Kemmel or Lekaramaki. I just have to think, just based on what's available right now on the list.
Yeah, and to recap, through 10 picks, Canada leads everyone with 3 picks. Slovakia, they kind of trumped everyone, though, because they took picks 1 and 2. USA with 2 picks. Czechia, of course, with 1. And Austria and Russia. And you mentioned the Russian factor, the invasion and the war with Ukraine. That's obviously maybe playing a role on some more talented players maybe being overlooked a little bit.
Probably two guys that, if you go back to the start of this draft year, would have been in that top 10, and those two guys would have been Ivan Mirshtuchenko and Danila Yurov, and it's still fascination exists to see where those players end up going, if they do still indeed go in the first round. If it does happen, it likely is going to happen with a team with multiple picks. We're seeing Arizona, we're seeing Buffalo, Anaheim, a lot of teams with multiple picks here in round one.
Yeah, you know what, it's actually a little bit unfortunate, isn't it, that we as grown adults are having that discussion, but it is a reality. This is pro sports after all, and these kids deserve to be drafted higher than maybe their draft slot's going to be. I think Yurov is a real possibility here in the next 2 or 3 picks, so that's a name I'm really watching here at 11, 12, or 13.
They need everything. I mean, we can establish that, right? There's been trouble off the ice. There's been trouble on the ice. Logan Cooley is going to be that dynamic player. You guys are all in love with him, especially Jason. And you've mentioned a couple of players you could see fitting in well with Arizona, but they're not a year away or 2 years away. We're talking a big rebuild here.
No, and both of those players I talked about, Kemmel out of Finland and Lekaramäki out of Sweden, David, they're both guys that are down the road. They're 2 or 3 years away from being ready to play, but when they can play, they're both NHL-style scorers.
Both those players have 2-year contracts still in in Europe, so definitely they're a ways away from coming over. Yep.
And that could play a role as well if a team's looking for immediate help. And again, they're looking for some good PR as well, as we see Bill Armstrong heading up to the podium. And Bill Armstrong, a big part of St. Louis's championship in 2019, and has had to sort of start from scratch here with the Arizona Coyotes. And again, Logan Cooley's a good big building block, and now moving up to the 11th pick, we will see what the Coyotes are going to do here, Sam.
Yeah, it's just fascinating that you have a plan that Bill Armstrong went and sold to the ownership group, and he is executing that plan maybe a lot faster. Not in terms of what they are in the NHL, but really stripping it down and getting a ton of picks and a ton of prospects and building right from the ground up. It's going to be fascinating to watch this group over the next 3 years, just to see what happens on ice and who is it that's actually playing for them in the NHL. Let's not forget they're a bit of a clearinghouse, too, when it comes to bad contracts.
Arizona Coyotes are proud to select from the Winnipeg Ice, Connor Geeky.
And there it is, Connor Geeky goes 11th overall to Arizona. We actually threw a mic on Connor as he's celebrating with his family. Congratulations. Special moment there with his family, his brother Morgan. Of course, a third round pick by Carolina. Connor, how you doing? Can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you guys fine.
Hold
on.
You're off to Arizona, my friend.
Yeah, no, it's a pretty cool feeling, pretty special for sure.
All right, well, you slipped a little bit there, and I can imagine there's a lot of nerves and a lot of anticipation. Your mic's falling off your shirt as well.
Yeah, no kidding, but no, a lot of fun for sure.
Well, congratulations to you.
And welcome to the NHL.
That's awesome. Say hi to the commish for us.
That's great.
Oh, that's wild. So Connor Geeky, guys, really charismatic, affable guy. He must have won over a lot of teams in that interview. And, of course, he can do it on the ice as well, out of Strathclair, Manitoba. Really exceptional player, 24 goals. And he likes everything. He likes hockey, but he also likes farming, and he's going out to the desert. We'll see if he likes the desert as well, Sam.
Yeah, and great baseball player. We saw Carolyn talk about the three Manitoba guys right off the top of the broadcast. This is the first of those three Manitoba players to move. And you have to love the size down the middle of the ice. That's a true Bill Armstrong characteristic.
Let's send it to Kyle.
David, a week ago yesterday, Connor Geeky graduated high school back home, a graduating class of 13 kids. Him and a buddy were co-valedictorians. You know, when his parents, Craig and Toby, decided they were going to have kids, the mom, Toby, just felt, I don't want my kids to be afraid ever of trying anything. You mentioned Morgan, now at the Seattle Kraken, the middle child, Noah, playing college ball down south, and now Connor Geeky, the newest member of the Arizona Coyotes. There is something in the water in Strathclair, Manitoba, David.
Oh, that is great stuff there. Yeah, and he's an all-around athlete, guys. I mean, he's played at a high level, baseball, badminton, pretty much every sport he can get his hands on. So it's really fun to see him now, though. Chose hockey, and it's been a path that's worked out for him. And Jason, here's a guy that there was a lot of positives and there were some question marks, but clearly they're pretty happy to have him in Arizona.
Well, the positives are evident. I mean, he handles the puck very well. He's got elite talent, elite NHL skill. He's a little bit, his skating has to come. I don't know how to put it any other way. Agility, turning to the one side. Sam and you and I were at the CHL Top Prospects game. When he breaks down the left wing and he's dropping the knee to come to the right side, he has a hard time. So there's some work to be done here. Great pick, though.
All right, let's send it down to Carolyn Cameron.
Connor, in 2017, when your brother was drafted, you were on the baseball diamond. So how does this experience compare?
Yeah, definitely a little different. I mean, I'm pretty lucky to have him here. You know, got my whole family here, so it's a pretty special moment. And obviously, I had my hopes up when they made the trade. So yeah, I'm super excited.
So I was able to speak with two of your buddies from Manitoba, Den Matejczak, you and Owen Pickering, just before the draft. I know so many people come to mind on a day like this, but what did the community do to help get you here?
Yeah, I mean, Strathclair is it's a special place in my heart always. I don't know if you heard the song, but it's written by someone from there as well. So, again, it means the whole world to me, whether it's a wave or a smile, it goes a long way.
Is that your way to just try and sing?
Yeah, I guess.
He sang at the Combine.
Yeah,
so.
I should have sang her song, I guess.
Well, congratulations, and good save on the stairs, too.
Yeah, I know.
It's a nerve-wracking.
Weird slip. It was weird.
David Amber's talking in your
ear.
Yeah, I was
confused.
A lot going on. Congratulations.
Perfect. Thank you.
I would have felt responsible had he fallen down the stairs. Thank goodness he didn't.
So here's Connor Geeky coming down the wing, and I think he's a guy that's going to have the option to play both positions. He is unique in that typically we think of these big guys as being power forwards. He's not really that. He's a really thoughtful player, and he's a guy that sometimes hangs on to the puck a little bit too long. He wants to make that perfect play. He has great creativity in this game, and oftentimes you don't see that when you have a big guy like that who has that kind of skill and creativity. We more think along the Gauthier power forward sides. This guy's a little bit of a unicorn in that regard.
Let's get back down to the draft floor with Elliot.
Well, did you just draft your two top centers for a long time?
Yeah, it's exciting time for us. We had a game plan getting out of the gate here and just using some assets that we had acquired during the year to, you know, get the guys we wanted. That was the most important thing. And, you know, when you build down the middle, you get a chance to win. And I think with the two guys that we've accumulated here quickly in the draft, they give us a chance in the future to win.
I ask all the tough questions. What's with the jackets?
Well, the jackets are probably my idea. I'm color coordinated, and I kind of expect everybody on our staff to do that. And, you know, they really hooked us up. They actually did the whole insides, too, with
wow.
The Yotes. So it's, I don't know if it's a new thing that's going to happen, but it'll be with the Yotes for years.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you.
David?
All right, leave it to Elliot to talk fashion here. Hey, he's a bit of a fashion guru, and fashion is part of the draft. I like to see a bit of the personality from the players. And, you know, you can hear in the background the Chicago Blackhawks goal song, right? That's blaring, I believe, right now. But who do we have going up there? We have Columbus up there with the 12th pick. And again, they've already picked sixth so far in this draft. And what might be seen here as well? You know what? We'll hear what we're seeing and we'll react to that. But we can tell you Columbus, they already have Juracek, a right-handed shot D-man at six, and now they pick at number 12.
With the 12th pick, Columbus Blue Jackets are proud to select from Western Hockey League Moose Jaw Warriors, Denton Matejczak.
Well, Dominion City, Manitoba has got to be high-fiving right now. Father Jason is a principal. His mother, Keela, is a teacher. And there it is. Denton Matejczak goes with the 12th pick to Columbus.
Hey, his mother was in the gym today working out really hard. I saw her, trust me. So she's as hardworking as the son. By the way, the son is an outstanding talent. More of a high-risk player than maybe some people want, but I can tell you one thing right now. He will contribute to the offense of this team in Columbus. The other thing is, if you look for an NHL comparable on this player, I'm going to say Tony DeAngelo of the Carolina Hurricanes. That's who I think he's very similar to.
I'm going to go against the grain there a little bit and say that this kid reminds me more of like Kimmo Timonen when I was back in Nashville back in the day. Compact frame, puck distributor, point producer. I had him 13 on my list and I was a little bit hesitant. I thought I might be high on him. This kid here is going to be a top two defender on projection. Worst case, he's a three. Yeah. But he makes everybody around him better.
So what's interesting about his story is that sometimes you have to take advantage of opportunities that are given to you. Damon Hunt was their top defenseman in Moose Jaw. He got injured, and that allowed Denton Mateychuk to step in there and play all of the important minutes that were being played by Damon Hunt. Secondly, it allowed him to take control of the room. And JB, when you and I saw him, that's one thing that was clearly evident. This guy can be a quarterback out there. He can be a policeman. He's directing people at the face-off, telling them where to go. But he has a little bit of a fun side as a captain, too. He puts the boom box around his neck before games. He's strutting down the hallway, getting his guys ready to go. He's got that type of personality. When he has to be serious, though, he can be serious.
Hey, I just, correct me if I'm wrong. Did the cousins, Geeky and Mateychuk, just go back-to-back?
Pickering's his cousin. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, my bad.
And I can tell you, this is an early birthday present for Denton Mateychuk because he turns 18 in 5 days. An unbelievable story there. Moose Jaw celebrating, Dominion City, Manitoba celebrating, and the WHL celebrating, guys. Three of the last four picks coming from the WHL. Much more coming your way. 12 picks are in, and we have the Jets. They're coming up with pick 14. The Canucks, they're coming up with pick 15. Lots of action rolling on. You're watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal. Welcome back to the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal on Sportsnet, hydrated by BioSteel. Denton Mateychuk, a huge smile as he's taken 12th overall by Columbus, and now he's joined with Carolyn Cameron. Carolyn.
It's an understatement to say it's exciting to hear your name called in the NHL draft, but what does it mean to you when it's called right after your good buddy, Connor Geeky?
Yeah, it's an unbelievable feeling. I was super happy for him to, you know, be drafted and then to go after him. It's awesome. Yeah, it's an unbelievable feeling.
Okay, you're not just interested in hockey. I know you're a good baseball player and fisher. So for a secondary sport, what are you better at, baseball or fishing?
I don't know. It's tough to say. My older brother plays baseball. My dad played baseball. I think I'm a pretty decent baseball player, but I really enjoy fishing, so I go with fishing.
Okay, I was already doing some scouting on Google Maps, and it looks like you got some lakes in the Cleveland area, and Lake Erie not too far away, so you'll be set up. Congratulations, and enjoy tonight.
Thank you.
Offensive defenseman, 13 goals, 51 points for Mark O'Leary and the Moose Jaw Warriors. Hey, wait a sec, you're a defenseman. What are you doing up on the rush? I recognized it was okay to do it. I'll beat the Medicine Hat Tigers. Yeah, I'm going to hang around in the offensive zone, gain a little space. Score on the one-timer. Again, up on the rush. What are we seeing with Mateychuk? And the one thing about Mark O'Leary is the head coach there. He's given him license to do that. It's one thing to be given license to do it, make mistakes, and then be held back. No. Keep going, learn, make a few mistakes, but you're most effective for us when you're playing that type of game, and it's worked well.
There's no question about it. It's worked well, but that's what I was talking about before. There's a little bit of high risk to his game, too, but he'll learn, and they'll teach him in Columbus to maybe mitigate some of that risk.
Well, I think you would agree, Pierre, especially being a former coach. You can't teach offense. Like, people can try and grab and say, oh, he can do that. Trust me, you can't teach offense at the NHL level. If he's got it in there and we can reel him in defensively in certain situations, that's a win.
100% agree.
And we'll see where his cousin Owen Pickering goes. I know he's anxiously awaiting to be selected as well. The Chicago Blackhawks, they've been very busy trading some players, the Bernkitt as well as Kirby Dach. But now they're on the podium because they do have the 13th overall pick. And let's hear what they're going to do. Kyle Davidson, the GM of the Chicago Blackhawks, expected to make a pick in a matter of moments.
The Chicago Blackhawks are proud to select from the United States National Development Team, Frank Naser.
What a nice celebration it is for Frank Naser. 13th overall, third player from the U.S. National Team Development Program. And remember, this is a program that's been doing such great things lately and getting guys to the National Hockey League, the latest Frank Naser.
That's great. He's so tight with his sisters. He gets to hug them all. That's just such an awesome experience for him. But he's a dog and a bone type player, a really good player who works in small spaces. He can score off the rush. He has the ability to play in tight spaces. And not only that, if he's able to win battles, which he does with good body positioning and good stick positioning, he has those first three steps to escape the pressure thereafter and them trying to get the puck back from him. So a guy who plays an all-around game, a guy who's got a lot of humility to him, you see that smile on his face, he's so excited, big crowd here for him. And interesting in that he grew up in the Detroit area, his dad owned a parking lot around there and he used to kind of sneak into some of those Detroit parades, and that's where he fell in love with the game, stayed in Michigan, and it's pretty awesome to see.
He talked about Michigan, he's going to the University of Michigan, and Matt Beniers is in Seattle, Johnny Beecher's in Boston. They're counting on him to be a top centerman at the University of Michigan.
Jeff Merrick.
So Kyle Davidson, this is his first NHL draft as a general manager in the NHL. He's taken a defenseman in Kevin Korchinski, now he takes a forward in Frank Naser. And if you have a look at the entire prospect pool of the Chicago Blackhawks, they have one really good prospect at each position. Up front, Lucas Reichel played 11 games with the Hawks last season. On the back end, Ian Mitchell bouncing between Rockford and Chicago. And netminder Drew Comesso right now playing as a standout at BU. They have some decent defensive depth at Nicholas Beaudet of AHL Rockford. Wyatt Kaiser plays at Minnesota Duluth. They need something high-end on the back end. They did that with Kevin Korchinski, and they need forwards with speed and some high-end scoring as well, David. And now Kyle Davidson has addressed that, drafting Frank Naser.
And if you're wondering if he's going to have some edge, well, I can tell you he's being mentored by Ryan Kessler. So Kurt Overhart was saying he's learning to have a little bit of a chip on his shoulder, Pierre.
No question. I know one thing they're worried about at the University of Michigan, his draft rights in the Ontario Hockey League are owned by the London Knights. And it's not a sure thing. And we better make sure that he gets it.
Well, that's an interesting thing to bring up. That's my hometown. The Hunters have had success with that type of acquisition, if you will.
Chicago, and I can tell you, the Jets in a matter of moments are going to be on the board, so we're going to have to try and get ahead of what's going on with the Winnipeg Jets, because that's an interesting situation for Kevin Cheveldayoff as them. In fact, the commissioner, Gary Bettman, are putting them on the clock right now. So, listen, Winnipeg missed the playoffs for the first time in 5 years, guys, and Kevin Cheveldayoff, he's been there, he's done this, third longest tenure GM in the league. He's been there for 11 years. What are your expectations for the Jets, and what are their greatest needs?
They're in a weird situation, I find, because you talk about Wheeler and Shifley, and we've talked about them forever and ever, yet it almost seems like this organization is ready to move on from one, if not both, of those players, and so that would implement a rebuild. But if you're able to hang on to one of them, and you're able to move some of that money out, that really changes the complexion of this team still trying to get back into the playoffs where they've had that successful run after missing last year.
There's also the question about Pierre-Luc Dubois and what's going to happen with Pierre-Luc Dubois long-term, so a lot of stress right now on Cheveldayoff.
All right, well, we can see it's a good poker face by Kevin Cheveldayoff. He's not giving anything. It looks like he knows who his guy is. He's just sort of making us wait it out. We're going to also wait for Frank Nazar to be joined by Carolyn Cameron in just a matter of moments as well. So the U.S. development team getting some traction, the WHL getting some love of late, and, of course, the Slovakians going 1-2, probably the biggest storyline so far tonight.
Oh, yeah, no question. I think when we came into this, we felt really strongly about Slovakian hockey and Slovakian players. To go 1-2 is simply fascinating. But the U.S. under-18 program will be measured up to the Jack Hughes draft with Cole Caulfield, Zegras, Turcotte. This group might not be as high-end, but it may produce the same sort of volume as that group.
I agree. 100% agree with that, too.
No, I agree with that statement as well. There's some interesting names coming up here, fellas. Some interesting scorers on the board.
All right, let's get back down on the floor with Carolyn.
And here with the newest member of the Chicago Blackhawks. And Frank, we saw you celebrating with your family. What was it like sharing that moment with them? And I know you always carry a special coin from your grandpa in your pocket.
Yeah, it's awesome. And I mean, honestly, I wish there could be more family here with me, man. You know, and we brought a lot. And yeah, it was just amazing. And I was kind of saying earlier, it's like, you're in a dream, and you're just not waking up from the dream, and it's your favorite dream ever, you know? So that's kind of the words I can use to explain it, but it's just, I'm so excited.
So your dad is a huge Red Wings fan. Do you think he's going to very quickly switch over to this jersey?
Yeah, he's definitely going to switch over. I mean, he's a Wings fan at the heart, but now he's always going to be a Chicago Blackhawks fan.
Well, congratulations. Best of luck.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, Frank Nizar, taken by Chicago, and all smiles and a great addition, great young man from all accounts, and here we see now the Winnipeg Jets and all the executives heading to the stage. Any final thoughts? Because the Jets, again, they're in an interesting situation. With, you mentioned Pierre-Luc Dubois. We know there's been, you know, speculation about moving some of the key parts. Could be a very big offseason here for Kevin Cheveldayoff.
One of the things I want to just pipe in about here, guys, when you get into this part of the draft and you're the Winnipeg Jets, you're not only trying to build more culture moving forward with the best available player, they also want to get some sustainability within the group. And so there's certain players on the draft board, the Finns, for example, the Swedes, they're more accustomed to living in a place like Winnipeg and enjoying to be there. I don't want to overplay it, but it does come into discussion at times.
And first of two first-round picks from the Jets. They also have the 30th pick, courtesy of the Andrew Kopp trade to the New York Rangers. So we'll be seeing more of the Jets later in this first round. We can also tell you the Vancouver Canucks, they are on deck with the 15th pick. But first, it's the Jets with the 14th selection here at the NHL Entry Draft in Montreal, hydrated by BioSteel.
Winnipeg Jets would like to thank the city of Montreal for their tremendous hospitality this week. Merci beaucoup. We'd like to extend our deepest condolences to the Marchment family as a Jets 1.0 draft pick. I'd like to acknowledge our season ticket members who are at our draft party back in Winnipeg at the Rec Room. And with the 14th pick, the Winnipeg Jets are proud to select from the U.S. National Development Program, Rutger McGroarty.
The celebration is on for Rutger McGroarty. His father, Jim, from Streetsville, Ontario. Oh, great moment there. He was a 50-goal scorer, BCHL, played in the ECHL and WCHL as well. This guy captained the U.S. under-18 team, 35 goals in 54 games. He can flat-out score. I think Jets fans are going to love this. Now, he is a University of Michigan commit, though.
An interesting guy. And in the BioSteel game, playing against Logan Cooley, he absolutely ran him over. And I think that speaks to the competitiveness. Here's a guy that he was playing with all season long and had no problem throwing that hit. When it comes to McGroarty, you talk about the skating, you worry about it a little bit. He's working with Barb Hunterhill to try and improve that area, but you're talking about a guy who wins battles despite that. He thinks the game extremely well. He brings that leadership to the table. Really good around the net. You have to love his hands. And anytime you're a captain of that U.S. under-18 program, that's a difficult task. You have a lot of big personalities in that room. He really embraced that role, took guys aside, and let them know what is right and what is wrong.
He's character personified, and you talked about him going to the University of Michigan. They hope he can turn out just like Kyle Connor, who went to the University of Michigan, well played for the Winnipeg Jets.
I think that's a fantastic point, because what you're looking at here is a player who does not transport the puck between the blue lines off the rush. He's a hash marks guy in the offensive zone. Hash marks down, crease front presence. Guys like Kyle Connor, they're going to get him the puck, and he's going to do what he does.
Our insider, Jeff Merrick.
You know, I spoke to Kevin Cheveldayoff in Buffalo at the Combine, guys, and one of the things he kept coming back to is we need to restock our prospect pool. We spent a lot of time competing up around the top part of the Western Conference, and it's cost us. Now, listen, they have a player like Cole Perfetti, who is a top high-end talent. He'll be a full-time Winnipeg Jet for a long time. You have a look up front as well. Last year, first round, they go with Chaz Lucius. Dmitry Kuzmin is a really nice piece. Dmitry Rachevsky is a nice piece as well. But you can't help but thinking, this is deliberate. They have some players on the back end coming. Ville Heinola has been there for a while. Dylan Sandberg, Simon Lundmark. But I think deliberately, Kevin Cheveldayoff is looking at his depth and saying, after Cole Perfetti and Chaz Lucius, what do we really have? This goes a long way to address that question, David.
Yeah, and you know what? He's born in Nebraska, just like Jake Guentzel. Some non-traditional places where we're seeing players come from. By the way, the cheer in the background again is they're loving Slafkovsky. Any move he makes, the fans here in Montreal are going crazy. So some wild stuff happening around us here in the stands as well. But it's Rutger McGroarty who goes 14th overall to Winnipeg. We'll be hearing from him in just a matter of moments. And again, Vancouver is on the board at 15. So pretty good picks have gone at 15. Joe Sakic, Al MacInnis were both picked at 15. We're not sure if Patrick Alvin in his very first pick with the Canucks is going to hit a home run like that. But it's good to know you can get a guy at 15 sometimes, and you have this diamond in the rough. And at 14, the Jets are hoping they have that with McGroarty.
Yeah, and McGroarty is that type of guy. You're not never going to worry about the leadership that he brings to the table. And you think about where his hockey path has taken him. He's born in Lincoln. His dad was the general manager of the USHL franchise there. He goes up to Michigan to play his minor hockey. His dad's from Toronto, so he spent some time there in the summers. He's all over the map to try and figure this thing out. And you have to appreciate anyone and their families willing to commit all that time and all that effort and all that money to make the player like they have at Rutger McGroarty.
And a big part of development is getting ice time. And the coaches at the University of Michigan are counting on him to be a big-time player to get him a lot of ice time early on. That speeds up your development significantly.
Well, you know, and we talk about this kid moving away from home at a young age, so there's that little bit of European flavor in an American product here. It speaks to his maturity, speaks to his commitment and his dedication.
And you know what? It's not just the player getting drafted that's celebrating. You see in their parents the relief, the joy, right? They're allowing, you know, they've done so many sacrifices to allow their kids to be here living out their dream. That's really the best part of this night. For 32 young men, this is going to be their dream coming true.
Well, you just saw it with Frank Nazar. I mean, it was just unbridled happiness. And I think some of these guys come in here and they think, oh, yeah, that's so cool.
His phone's blowing up, you know that.
I should have gone here. I should have gone there. Love that. This guy's been around hockey his whole life, and he's bawling his eyes out. You got to love it. It's fantastic to see that. But again, the unbridled enjoyment that comes from these guys. Frank Nazar hugging his three sisters. Like, so cool to see that experience live and on TV.
All right, let's head it down to Carolyn.
Rutger, you're looking at your dad there. You're going, he's crying. What's more surprising than he's crying or on the phone?
I don't know. I mean, he's a working man, so I love that he's on the phone talking to people, but he's a little ball baby. Yeah, he said he wasn't going to cry, but he's a little ball baby. I knew it.
Was that the best walk of your life, hugging your parents, your family, and then seeing your U.S. teammates?
Yeah, it was unbelievable. I mean, just all the support. You heard I got like 100 people here, so it was unbelievable. I think I just blacked out there, and I'm lucky I didn't fall down the stairs, so it was awesome.
What's Barb Underhill meant to your career in the past year working with her?
Barb's the best. I mean, she's taught me so many different things, just from mechanics to just staying loose, just a little bit of everything. Honestly, she's my very first skating coach, so it's unbelievable, and I love her.
Well, congratulations.
Thank
you. Enjoy
the
rest of the night.
Thank you. Thank you. Means a lot.
All right, great stuff there from Carolyn. Vancouver, they're about to make their first pick. They haven't had a first-round pick in the last couple of years. Remember the OEL trade, the JT Miller trade. So they're excited to get a first-round pick, and it's at number 15. They don't have a second-round pick, so they put a lot of emphasis here on this first-round pick. Any thoughts on what they might be looking to do?
When I was thinking about Vancouver with no second-round picks, I thought this was going to be a prime area in which a trade-back existed. But I think about a couple of guys that I had up on the board, in Kemmel and Lekkerimäki, and then maybe they think that there's going to be value in one of those players as opposed to trying to gain an additional asset by trading out of the 15th spot.
I know in February, I was over in Finland and Sweden, and the man all the way to the left of your screen is Todd Harvey. I spent a lot of nights in hotel lobbies with him. He was over in Europe watching Kemmel and Lekkerimäki.
Well, let's hear what Patrick Alvin. They've reshaped their front office, of course, with all sorts of additions. And, you know, Cammy Granato, Emily Castonguay, assistant GMs. And they're making their pick now.
The Vancouver Canucks are proud to select from Sweden the SHL Djurgården Jonathan Lekkerimäki.
And maybe no surprise, guys, Patrick Alvin, he knows the talent out there, and you're shaking your head, Jason, because you know he probably has a very good sense of this player.
For me, this was predictable when this player kind of fell on their lap here. You know, they've had some success, obviously, with Elias Pettersson there. They've had other success with a couple of Swedes that had a pretty good run in Vancouver over the years and might be going, well, they are going in the Hall of Fame here, you know, in the near future. This kid here, pure goal scorer. He lacks a lot of detail. But I'll tell you, when the game's on the line and you need a goal, somebody gets a puck out of a corner, puts it on his stick, he's putting it in the back of the net.
He's a legitimate sniper, big-time sniper. The biggest thing for him right now, you can see the frame's not overly large and the skating's not super great for a smaller guy. This is a development player. It's not somebody that's turned pro in the next 2 years. He needs time.
Sam, 5'11", 165, but he'll fill out. And what do you think about this pick?
You know, it's interesting because when we had him in the room in the combine to meet him, he's a pretty well put together considering he doesn't weigh a lot. So there is a lot of room to put some muscle onto that frame to add a little more weight. And you hope when doing so that he doesn't lose that ability to shoot the puck because the release is big time. It's NHL ready right now.
And he turns 18 in 2 weeks. We forget how young some of these prospects are, right? Like some of them are, you know, 18 in a bit. This guy isn't 18 yet, just 17 years of age, slipping on the Vancouver Canucks sweater.
I was watching him play against Men in Djurgården, and he handled himself unbelievably well in some pretty intense moments.
26 games in the Swedish Elite League, scored 7 goals. As you guys mentioned, the one thing that we hear about him repeatedly is skilled score.
Yeah, no, there's absolutely no question. There is some cheat in his game. I mean, this is a guy that's going to have to be coached up a bit, and when he gets here, there's going to be some frustrating nights. We see guys like this in the league, right? On any given night, they frustrate you a little bit, but then all of a sudden you need a big goal in overtime. Let's bank the 2 points. We're a playoff team all of a sudden.
You think about William Nylander a little bit?
Without the speed.
Without the speed.
Without the speed.
But sometimes they'll frustrate you on nights, and when you need a big one,
100%.
He's the guy to do it. He's
100%.
Got that kind of ability.
Absolutely.
Jason, you've shed some light on what we can expect from Lakira Mäki. Give us some more.
Well, here he is on his strong side flank. You're going to see a release top bar down. He works the back flank a lot. Here he is on the back flank on the power play. That's his wheelhouse, similar to, you know, an Ovechkin type of setup. He doesn't shoot it like that, but you're getting my drift. Again, coming late, shooter, boom. He's not looking necessarily to make a secondary play out of a given goal in the neutral zone. That's a slick play. I mean, the kid's got wicked hands, pure offense.
You guys expecting some more moves from Patrick Alvin? There's been so much speculation. I think it might have been Elliott who dropped sort of the, you know, the JT Miller, you know. Oh, well, you know what? We don't even have to speculate anymore. We got Patrick Alvin downstairs with Elliott Friedman. Go ahead, Elliott.
Patrick, first of all, the pick. There were some Canucks fans hoping he would be your selection once he started to drop that far. Did you get a sense that this could happen with you tonight?
Well, we got a little bit of a sense that it could happen there when he was, we had him obviously a little bit higher on the radar there, and we're excited that it was falling down there.
How much work do you think he has to do before he's ready?
Well, I think a lot of those younger players here obviously need to get stronger. I mean, he's a skilled, smart player playing at the pro level here this year. So, you know, there's no rush for us with Jonathan to getting over. So we'll take our time here and work with him.
All right. There were some rumblings tonight that you were maybe up to something with the Islanders. Anything going on there?
No comment on that one.
All right. Thanks very much. Really appreciate it.
Great. Thanks.
Dave? This is why Elliott is fantastic at what he does. He asks the tough questions, but he does it with this great smile on his face. So Patrick Alvin can't even yell at him. You know, now that he's not on TV, Patrick Alvin's going, quit doing that to me. Oh, that's awesome. But listen, the Canucks get a score, something they're desperately in need of. They want to add more depth on the offense, and this is a guy who can do that. We're going to be sitting on the clock right now for the Buffalo Sabres in about a minute and a half. But as far as Vancouver's concerned, do you guys, Elliott asked the question, we got a no comment from Patrick Alvin. Do you guys expect there's going to be some more movement in terms of possible trades from the Canucks?
JT Miller, I mean, he's a guy that's a perfect fit for just about anyone. And with the money that's owed to him, it's not like you're going to get killed on the cap. So you're going to get a hard, heavy guy. One of those guys that probably pushes a really good team over the top, like a Washington Capitals, maybe to make one more run, like a New York Rangers, where they need a little bit of that grit and determination. I think that's imminent. I think with the way this draft has gone, you really got to pay attention to what's going on. It's kind of a little bit shifty, so you might not have had time to do that business here tonight, but hey, you've got tomorrow, and then of course you got free agency, so there's a lot of time to get that sorted out if that's the road they want to go down.
I would expect that they're going to do some business, and not just on the amateur side, on the pro side too. And I don't like speculating about players being traded. It's just, I don't think it's appropriate. But JT Miller's name has been out there for a long time.
Well, here it's appropriate. It's okay here.
Yeah, I understand.
There's the human side of things. We get that too. But yeah, I know that's kind of what we do. It keeps us in business, speculating on things. Even if we don't know what we're talking about, we can speculate a little bit on it. Kevin Adams for the second time tonight making his way up to the podium. Of course, Matthew Savoy, a skilled player, a slick player at number 9 and now at number 16. Any ideas what Buffalo might be up to here, Jason?
You know what? Sooner than later, we're going to start to see a wild card drop in on this draft list. So what are they going to do? I honestly, at this point in the list, don't have a clue, except for the fact that there's still some outstanding names. I mean, look at where Kemmel's going right now.
Wow.
You know, like, very surprised he's dropped into the 16 hole. There are some other guys that play the middle of the ice that are still available as well that could really surprise here at this pick.
Well, let's hear what they have to say. The Buffalo Sabres back on the podium.
With the 16th pick, the Buffalo Sabres are proud to select from your garden in the Swedish Hockey League, Noah Åslund.
Another Swedish player, Noah Åslund, a center out of Sweden. And a celebration all around up in the CAA group with the 16th overall pick.
Crazy high skill level. And Jason, he makes players around him better. There's no question about that.
One of the most competitive players at the under 18 championships in Germany for Team Sweden. He played in all situations. Here he's picking up a puck off the rush, little pocket play, distributes it into the net off his back end. Here he is off the wall. Think of it, watch him here. Think of Austin Matthews for a second. The regroup in the neutral zone. You forget about me here for a second, boom, I got open ice, it's in the back of the net. Let's win a key face-off with the game on the line, gold medal game versus Team USA. Not a one-trick pony. Don't let the size of this player concern you in the least. Highly competitive, electric offensively, great detail defensively.
He is a tremendous athlete. He makes things happen with his hand-eye coordination. And the thing to me that really stands out, Sam, he makes everybody around him better. He's got eyes all over his head. It's unbelievable.
It's crazy. Him walking up to the stage, I mean, he looks young. He looks like he's 14, 15 years old. That speaks to me of great growth potential with his ability to add strength, to add muscle, maybe grow another inch or two. My goodness, he just looks so young. I would love that if I'm the Buffalo Sabres. I can mold this putty any way I like it.
Back-to-back draft picks from Djurgården, by the way. Yes. Lekker, Mackey, and Åslund.
It's funny how that works out, because you go in to watch one player and you get the added value of being able to watch three players. And so Djurgården obviously doing a good job with their young players and giving them the opportunity to play, which is key.
And that third player you're talking about, Liam Ågren, he's going to be on the board probably pretty soon too.
He's considered a bit of a physical specimen guy. 6.8% body fat. That was the composition he had at the combine, the best of anyone. Gold in the under-18s as well for Sweden. So you were talking about his hand-eye. Well, take a look, Pierre. You were talking just about this a minute ago.
I had a chance to witness it overseas when I was over there scouting this year. You just see he's plugged in. He's got tremendous coordination. He's an outstanding athlete. Look at him drive right through the American defense. But he makes the players around him better, David.
Let's send it off to the commissioner who's on the podium.
Long-time general manager and NHL executive Jim Gregory was perhaps one of the most beloved figures in the history of the National Hockey League. In his memory, the general manager of the award, of the year award is named. To present the Jim Gregory NHL GM of the year is longtime Montreal Canadian, both as a player and a general manager, and a member of the Hockey Hall of Fame, Serge Savard.
Hey, I thought we were going to Jason.
Bonsoir, bonsoir tout le monde. Vous savez, la dernière fois que le commissaire a été applaudi ici à Montréal, c'est lorsqu'il nous a présenté la Coupe Stanley en 1993. Alors, c'est un grand honneur pour moi d'être ici ce soir pour vous présenter le trophée Jim Gregory qui est décerné au gérant général de l'année dans la Ligue nationale de hockey. It is a great pleasure, it's an honor for me to be here tonight to give the general, to honor the general manager of the year in the National Hockey League. This is a Jim Gregory trophy. When I think of Jim Gregory, I think of a hard-working guy. I think of honesty and integrity. Here's the three finalists. Crazy, crazy, crazy.
from the Tampa Bay Lightning, Julian Brisebois.
They were up against the salary cap, but they rebuilt. Julian Brisebois deserves a lot of credit.
The Lightning advance to the Stanley Cup Final for the third straight season, hoping to be crowned a dynasty.
From the New York Rangers, Chris Drury.
Congratulations to Chris Drury, the GM that had to make some tough decisions. They got some real superstars on the team.
What a year for the New York Rangers.
From the Colorado Avalanche, Joe Sakic.
This is a team that had a clear purpose. Joe Sakic, what a job he's done as general manager.
They've reached the sevens. The Avalanche.
Wow. Le gagnant, the winner is the great Joe Sakic.
First of all, thank you very much to the fans. Merci, merci beaucoup. A vous les partisans. Anyways, it's a huge honor, the Jim Gregory Award. Truly grateful for this. I want to thank all my fellow general managers for this. It's just a pleasure being in the fraternity and really proud of this award. I tell you what, I couldn't have done it. Obviously, we're... Oh, sorry. This usually goes to winning teams, and I can't thank our coaching staff led by Jared Bednar, all of our players. I got to tell you, it was a pleasure watching them. I had the privilege of watching those guys day in, day out this year, show that commitment to one another and persevere and find a way to win the Stanley Cup. So we wouldn't be here without those guys. My staff, Chris McFarland, you're a huge part of this. Big help. All of our scouts, our pros, our amateurs, everybody in the office. This award's really for you. It's an organizational award. I also want to thank ownership, Stan and Josh Kroenke. They're giving us that opportunity, sticking with us and believing in the process. So I want to thank them. And most of all, my family. My wife, Deb. I love her so much, being there supporting me and my kids, my three kids, Mitchell, Chase, and Cameron. Couldn't have done this without you. So thanks again, and to all the young players here, congratulations and best of luck.
The 17th selection in the 2022 NHL draft belongs to the Nashville Predators. Nashville, you're on the clock.
Congratulations to Joe Sakic, well deserved. How about some hugs, kisses, and some tears of joy for the families of the 16 picks so far taken tonight? 16 down, 16 to go. We're halfway home. You're watching the 2022 NHL entry draft, hydrated by BioSteel.
GM of the year, Joe Sakic. I'm wondering, there's so many things you have to do right to win. Is there a move or anything that you guys did that you particularly think of that stands out?
I don't know about one move, but first of all, I got a great staff, and everybody works so hard to make it happen. But we just had such a tremendous team, and right from the start of the year, they believed in each other. They were committed to doing the right things all year, and for me, it was a pleasure. But But yeah, every player that we brought in, we're had that same commitment, fit right in with us, with the group, and I'm sure they felt part of it, like they were here all year. And you know, all those guys deserve credit for coming in and helping our group. And I mentioned it. It was a pleasure watching our team, just seeing their commitment to one another.
Congratulations, Joe. Nationals going up to the podium. Enjoy.
All right, thank you.
All right.
To say hello to our great fans in Nashville watching from Florida Ice tonight. With our first choice, Nashville Predators select from JYP in Finland, Joakim Kemmel.
Well, there it is, Nashville at 17, Joakim Kemmel, right winger out of Finland, known to have a great shot, and he actually was third in goals at the Helenka Gretzky Cup. A player that a lot of people thought maybe even would have gone a bit higher than 17, no?
And if he didn't get injured, I think that's what we'd be looking at, someone who was in the top 10. For the first month and a half of the season, he was leading Liga in scoring. And if you go back to the great Finnish players in their first year of draft eligibility, typically that success translates to the National Hockey League. If you want to think about Rantanen or Barkov, these types of players. So when he was leading the league at that point, you thought, wow, this guy's unbelievable with what he's doing at 17 years old. And then he got injured, shoulder issues, wasn't really good at the World Juniors because he wasn't completely healthy. Then the World Juniors get canceled and he's kind of hanging around. He finally gets back and he can't pick up the same pace that he had previous to the injury. But then he goes to the under-18s, proves to everyone, okay, everything's okay now. I'm back to being the guy that was a top 10 pick before the injury.
I had the pleasure of watching him live, several viewings at the under-18s. Big overtime goal versus Team Canada, carried the team on his back to get them into the medal round and beyond. Interesting thing here, great. Something I noticed, and I just have to share this with our viewers, is when we're in the scouting fraternity and we see whatever scout carries the jersey up to the stage, and as soon as I saw Jani Kekalainen right there, the Finnish scout, with the jersey in his hand, I could guarantee Kemmel was getting picked. And it seems like a small thing, but trust me, everybody else starts readjusting their draft grid when they see something small like that going up on the stage.
Interesting. Funny, that's a good little subtle hint. By the way, Finland's such an incredible hockey nation. That's the first Finn we've seen taken tonight. Maybe a bit of a surprise. I mean, every time you have some ups and downs as far as the country goes, but a bit of a surprise just because they put in so many quality NHL players.
Yeah, and they'll tell you that Slavkovsky played in Finland.
True enough.
I'm just kidding, by the way. But no, you're absolutely right. And I think Sam's point is really well taken in terms of the injury to Joakim Kemmel, because I saw him a lot this year, both on TV and live over in Finland, and there was a total difference between before the injury and after.
You know, what's interesting too is because in some of the early draft, the NHL Central Scouting, 5'10", 5'11", then at the combine he was listed at 5'9 and a half. I gotta tell you, I saw him last night. He has put together, this young man. He was at one of the agency parties, and he is really well put together. And that 5'9 and a half, I don't think that's the case. He might have grown an inch or two since the end of the combine, and that, to some people, say, hey, it might have made a difference if you were a little bit taller, but I don't think there's an issue there.
About our insider, Jeff Merrick.
You know, Nashville's a fascinating team here. You know, it's a squad that has a prospect pool that needs more high-end talent. Fedor Svechkov is a first-round pick. Zachary LaRue comes in from the Halifax Mooseheads, both taken in the first round last season, along with Luke Evangelista from the London Knights, you know, a first from last year's draft. All these are really good forward prospects, but what the Nashville Predators are really looking for here is a slam dunk. You'll wonder, because this player just slid, if they have one now in Kemmel. He's standing by with Carolyn Cameron.
And yo, Kim, I want to show you a picture, because as a young boy in Finland, did you ever think that this was perhaps a possibility?
That's a wonderful photo, and actually, I wear
I were maybe 6 or 7 years old, and was a Christmas, and I got new skates, and I loved it.
You'll be sleeping in this tonight, then.
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
I was going to say, I'm not sure what's nicer, though. Those skates or the custom suit tonight? We saw the sparkles on the outside, and then tell us about the liner, too.
Yeah, and the suit was awesome. I loved it.
Nice custom liner for a lot of the clients in Newport. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Best of luck with your career.
Thank you.
All right, Carolyn, there's Joakim Kemmel, 17th overall to Nashville. And the big storyline around Nashville, guys, is going to be Philip Forsberg. And can they get a deal done with this UFA? Not a lot of traction right now between the agent for Philip Forsberg and David Poile, but we'll see what this amounts to, because they are so good at drafting, so good at accumulating players. In fact, speaking of David Poile, he's standing by with our Elliot Friedman.
The group was talking upstairs. Kemmel fell a bit, and they bet your guys were pretty excited to see that happen.
Feel a little bit lucky. I mean, I know that we always say the same thing. Can't believe the player was there, but we had him rated in our top 10 at 17. I think that's pretty good. We did not feel that he would be there, so it's a little bit of a surprise for us, but maybe a good start to the next season to get that player.
There have been some conflicting reports on Philip Forsberg. Anything getting close with him with a week to free agency?
We're talking every day. We know we have a deadline. Sometimes you have a deadline that makes things happen. It's our first and only option right now, so we'll exhaust everything we can do to get him signed.
Thanks very much, David.
Okay, Elliot.
Jeff?
You know, one of the undercurrents or one of the subtle stories that's going on here at the draft and around the NHL hockey world, and the world for that matter, is the Russian factor and players trying to leave to come back to the NHL. The Nashville Predators have a first-round pick back in 2020, a netminder, a really good one too, by the name of Yaroslav Askarov. And Ivan Fedotov, the Philadelphia Flyers, we all saw what happened to him a couple weeks ago, unable to leave Russia, sent to a military base in northern Russia. I communicated with someone in Nashville today. They said that Askarov has done his military service. He's good to come over. They believe he's going to arrive on Sunday and start development camp on Monday. So good news for Askarov.
All right, thank you, Jeff. As we see, the Dallas Stars are ready to make their pick at number 18. Let's hear from the Stars and who they're about to take.
We'd like to thank Jeff Molson, the Montreal Canadiens, and the wonderful city of Montreal. Also, a shout out to our official draft watch party in Dallas at the owner's box. The Dallas Stars are pleased to select from Lexand, Leon Bixel.
Leon Bixel, the first Swiss player taken in this draft, goes 18th overall to the Dallas Stars. And Dallas, of course, looking to add a bit of youth to their blue line, gentlemen.
Well, they got Thomas Harley, who's on the rise here, but one thing that they lack in that back end is that heaviness. You know, you think about when Alexiak left a couple of years ago, that heaviness doesn't exist as much for Dallas as it once did. And Bixel's a guy who has no problem playing that type of game. Here, he's angling off the opponent. All right, you got away, but not for long. I'm going to munch you into the boards. Same sort of thing here. In on the chase, he eliminates the man. Puck started to be breaking out. And now you see him, all right, I'm going to add a little offense as well. Here, I step into it, good wrist shot. But what I like about this guy is that old school mentality. You see him posing on the play, the final part of the pack. The fact that he is out there to hit, to make sure that you know whenever he's out on the ice. And I think that's really important moving forward here for Dallas.
I can just tell you, this is a description on, he's got a big body and he uses it. And that's really important going forward for him. And it is just like Jamie Oleksiak. And he plays better with skilled players. He insulates skilled players. That's going to help him a lot down in Dallas.
6'5", 215. And remember, he's the first Swiss-born D-man picked in the first round since Mirko Mueller back in 2013 by San Jose, who went 18th overall. So I'm sure they're enjoying things in Switzerland with another bona fide NHLer coming out at number 18, Jason.
Well, I think the development is going to be really important for the player. He's an absolute giant of a defenseman. There's no question. So when he has time and space and arrives appropriately, he swallows people up. What I'm going to be looking for, though, in the North American game is his post-to-corner quickness and coming back, defending down low, Pierre, in his zone. He's going to have to improve a little bit that way. He's going to put in the work, no question. And I have to say, at 6'5", 226, he's the first draft guy tonight to come up with the snazzy white shoes on stage, which is an added bonus. Nice. You have to be 6'5", 230 to be able to do that.
Yeah, fashion's been a big part of the night. We heard Carolyn in some of the interviews as well. To Jeff Merrick.
You know, this is a team, you know, very much in need of a defenseman like this, as the guys have just been talking about, because it's a team with three solid forward prospects that will all join the mix sooner than later. Wyatt Johnson, first rounder last year with the Windsor Spitfires, he's going to be given every chance to start with the Dallas Stars next season. We look at Maverick Bork of Shawinigan, monster season, led the team to a Q title and a Memorial Cup berth as well. He's a first rounder from 2020. Logan Stankoven of the Kamloops Blazers, 104 points in the regular season, 31 more in the playoffs to lead all goal scorers. He looks great. As Sam mentioned, many expect Thomas Harley to stick next season, but they identified a need, and that is fill the prospect pool with defensemen. The Dallas Stars are set up front. They need help on the edge, and they addressed it on the back end with the gentleman standing next to Carolyn Campbell.
Well, Leon, it's the middle of the night in Switzerland, but you're confident your grandma is very much awake and celebrating?
Of course, like the whole family's up. They're all together by me at home, and yeah, it's a great, great night.
Well, you play in the top league in Sweden. How do you think that's prepared you for the NHL?
Really a lot. It was a tough year last year, and mentally also, like, I needed to go through a lot of things, and it was a big show last year.
You've been to the States twice. Have you ever been to Dallas?
Yeah, at the U18, we was in Texas, Dallas, and yeah, it was a great city there, and yeah.
Well, enjoy your time there. Congratulations.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.
David?
All right, Carolyn, it is truly an international game. Take a look at this. I mean, we've had nine different countries represented in the first round. That ties an NHL record from 2014 and 1999. Bishelet, a Swiss player, and here is what we've seen in previous years in 1999 again. So it's really spread out throughout many continents here, nine different countries represented. And for those keeping track, we're 18 picks in. We've had 12 forwards. We've had six defensemen. We haven't yet had a goalie. We're not expecting a goalie in the first round. What do you make of what we're seeing, though, this international flavor this year?
Well, it's really cool. And I think what happens sometimes is that players retire and maybe they go back to their home countries and they start to change things a little bit. Or sometimes North American players that played in the National Hockey League end up going to other countries and try and implement some of the things that made them successful as players or coaches in North America. And I think about Craig Ramsey, and I think about how the Slovakian game has changed, where they used to play defense and be a country that didn't want to be scored against. Now they're an attack country. They're encouraging their young players to go out and play offense to try and beat other teams as opposed to prevent them from scoring. And I love that change in mentality, because the young players these days, they're so talented, they're so skilled. They're all about improving in those areas and not just being guys who want to be good hockey players, but really excel and be elite hockey players.
You know, it's funny, we'll talk about Slovakia for a second. Talk about players putting their money where their mouth is. So Dano Chara, Marian Gaborik, Marian Hossa, all play for Duke Letrenchen. They helped build a rink for Duke Letrenchen with their own money. That's how much they care about giving back to their society.
Yeah, I think, Sam, just real quick, you hit on a very valuable point. Some of these countries used to play not to lose.
Yeah.
Now they're playing to win, and what you're seeing is skilled players developing and coming here to the National Hockey League.
I can tell you the Minnesota Wild are making their way to the podium. Bill Guerin, the GM, in fact, he has this pick, 19. He also has pick number 24 coming up in a matter of moments. This was, of course, courtesy of L.A. in that trade for restricted free agent Kevin Fiala, who signed a big deal with the Kings. So Minnesota, first of two picks over the next five picks. And again, Minnesota had a franchise record for wins and points. Didn't have a lot of playoff success, though. So they're trying to add something for the immediate future here. Let's hear what they have to say.
We'd like to thank the Montreal Canadiens, the City of Montreal, for being such gracious hosts. Congratulations to Joe Sakic and the Colorado Avalanche, and our deepest condolences to the San Jose Sharks and the Marchment family. And with our first pick, we'd like to pick from your garden, Liam Ogren.
So Liam Ogren, a right winger out of Sweden, the fifth straight European player taken in this draft, goes to the Minnesota Wild. Known as a player with a lot of skill, naturally, to be taken this early on. Jason, give us the whole scouting report, though, on Ogren.
Captain of Team Sweden at the U18 Championships in Germany, came into the tournament suffering from a high ankle sprain and fought through it. What you just saw there is his tenacity and his willingness to go that extra little bit to win a puck battle and to score a key goal. Here he's coming off the rush, chip out of his zone, quick give and go to the net, boom, let's put the puck behind the U.S. goaltender. Forehand, backhand, stick skill, 200-foot game, big body, has shown he can elevate in the toughest time of year, played through injury. I love his character.
He should have been taken earlier. I'm just telling you right now, I saw him a ton. This is a character player with serious skill. I couldn't agree more with Jason.
Why do you think he slipped?
I don't know. Well, why did Kemmel slip? I don't know.
Well, you guys said off the top, it was a bit of a crapshoot.
Yeah, we knew it was going to be kind of all over the map. I mean, a lot of the names that we projected to be here are here, but the order is a little bit different than maybe we expected it to be. But, of course, we said that there's going to be some volatility going into this draft class. And, again, we talk about no discernible ledges means, hey, there are guys that some teams have extremely high on their list, where another team might have that same player 10, 15 spots, or maybe even out of the round altogether. So I guess the one thing that we haven't talked enough about this guy is that he does play with some heaviness, with some bite to his game to go along with that skill. So when you marry the will and the skill together, plus you add the leadership qualities, it's pretty cool. There was a little bit of background noise surrounding this player going into Sweden. I think the team had to do their due diligence to make sure that some of those things off ice were okay, and it looks as if Minnesota felt comfortable with
Barry,
that.
Barry Smith was a coach in Djurgården. He's a good friend of mine, coached in the NHL for a long time. He coached this player, and he says all that other stuff you're talking about was a bunch of nonsense.
All right, well, this is live TV. You all know that, and including for the teams. There's lots going on the draft floor. Minnesota has two picks in 5, in 19 and 24. And they actually forgot the jersey. They forgot to bring the sweater up. They had to find a sweater for him. It was like, uh-oh, get him a sweater. He's a member of our franchise now. You're watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal. Washington and Pittsburgh are coming up on Sportsnet, hydrated by BioSteel. Carolyn Cameron out on the floor with the newest member of the Minnesota Wild, Liam Ogren.
Liam, as a little kid growing up in Sweden playing hockey, did you imagine this moment? Is this what you expected?
I mean, it's been a dream my whole life, and I've always looked forward to this and always dreamed of it. But yeah, it's a dream come true for sure.
Well, and your dad's in the hockey world. He's a strength and conditioning coach. He's worked with the likes of Gabriel Landeskog. So how, not just in the last few years, but your whole life, how has he helped prepare you to be an NHLer?
Yeah, he's helped a lot, of course. And just to get to train with people like Gabriel Landeskog and Nick Backstrom and all those guys, it's been really good for me and really inspiration for me. So a big thank you to him.
Well, congratulations and have fun tonight.
Thank you.
All right, rivalry renewed. This was Alexander Ovechkin, the number one pick many, many moons ago. And what about Sid the Kid, the number one pick as well? Those are the new next two teams picking, Washington at 20 and Pittsburgh at 21. I'm not sure they're going to land a home run, gentlemen, like they had with those. Those were slam dunks. But yeah, still some quality players left to be picked, as Brian McClellan, the senior VP and GM of the Caps, will be making the selection in a matter of moments. Any thoughts here very quickly, Sam?
Well, you look at Washington, they've had a pretty good track record of drafting and drafting in this area, but even at 20, this is one of the higher picks they've had in the first round in a long time. Always competitive, always in the fight.
And they're an older team, 13 players under contract, 30 plus years, so they're going to add some youth right now in
Washington
Montreal.
Washington Capitals select from Omsk, Russia, Ivan Reshnichenko.
Well, we talked about the Russian factor, but that didn't seem to scare off the Washington Capitals, who, of course, have a captain in Alexander Ovechkin. You've been big on this player. You've had a lot to say about this player. What's the scouting report here, Jason?
Well, can we just get the feel-good story out of the way first? Not only the Russian factor, but the boy had to overcome a cancer diagnosis this year, and that's a feel-good story to begin with. But, hey, tenacious competitor, hard player in the hard areas, active to space, pucks to the net, leads by example. This, for me, Sam, was a potential top 10 pick for sure at the beginning of this draft cycle.
Especially going into the draft year. But if you're Ross Mahoney and the rest of that scouting staff, Steve Bowman,
you're thinking about, we're going to have to watch this guy a lot on video because of the cancer diagnosis, because of the fact that you didn't get an opportunity to see him maybe as much as you would have liked, but you're talking about an organization that's got great intel in Russia.
And well, I just want to say something real quick, sir, Pierre. Ross Mahoney and Steve Bowman in the scouting fraternity for North Americans spend, I think, the most amount of time in Europe scouting Europe products. So this isn't a surprise that they would have a significant amount of intel.
Yaroshchenko is the pure scorer. He might have the best shot in the draft. He really might. I mean, this is a legit player. And if he had not had the cancer diagnosis, he would have gone much earlier than this.
Yeah, he's recovering from Hodgkin's lymphoma. We wish him, of course, the best, and he's able to get back to hockey activities. That's a great story. There was the captain of Russia's gold medal team, of course, at the 2021 Alenka Gretzky Cup as well, Ivan Yaroshchenko. Go on, Sam.
Well, there's a couple of teams that we looked at that thought might go down this road. I think you're thinking about Tampa, you're thinking about Detroit, you're thinking about teams with multiple picks, and definitely Washington was one of those teams because they've got a lot of currency with Russian players. And anytime you go and draft that player, you want him to feel comfortable, especially this young guy, for all that he's been through. So he's going to be welcomed with open arms. And I think it's quite interesting that he's actually in the building here on site, which probably clears at least one major hurdle.
I agree with that. The agency brought him over early this spring after he got the healthy diagnosis that he could travel and, you know, not be worried about anything. This is just a great story, and he's got significant offense up there.
And what makes it an even greater story is, look at this, Mario Lemieux sending him a get well message, a man that had to battle cancer himself.
I love that. That's awesome. Hockey is such a tight-knit community. A lot of people cheering for Ivan Yaroshchenko, 20th overall pick, going to Washington. So much going on, right? Obviously, as you mentioned.
You know, one kind of element that they were able to explore was he was getting treatment in Germany, and the under-18s were over in Germany. So at that point, he was exposed to a lot of teams that wanted to talk to him, see how he was doing, try and get the medical reports to see if he was going to be cured. And that's I think that probably played a key part in this as well.
All right, let's get back on the floor with Elliot Friedman.
Well, as you have all been talking, this is a great story because of what Yaroshchenko has been through. Brian, what made you comfortable enough to make the pick?
I mean, we went over the risks. You know, I think we got the medical report. We went through our doctors. You know, I think we're somewhat comfortable with the risk, and I thought our guys thought the upside was worth taking the risk involved. He's a really good player. They like the personality, they like the character, like what he's battling through right now, and you know, hopefully it works out. And we got a really good player on our hands.
Thanks very much, Brian.
Thanks,
Dave. All right, Elliot, he has us covered on the floor, and we've got Steve Dangle and Colby Armstrong. They've got us covered live streaming the draft on YouTube, a different twist on all the things. They have plenty of guests, lots of fun reaction to the great personalities in the game, Steve Dangle and Colby Armstrong, and of course they're hydrated by BioSteel, so check that out on YouTube if you want another alternative to keep track of the last 12 picks coming tonight in Montreal at the 2022 draft. And again, Washington just went 20th. And, you know, you heard their GM explain their pick. And now you have Pittsburgh at 21, about to take the podium with GM Ron Hextall. 16 straight playoff appearances, guys. I mean, this is the blueprint for how you run a sports organization. And now they're going to add some more talent. And they added Chris Letang, by the way, for 6 years and $36 million today, which questions what's going to happen with Evgeny Malkin. Maybe they want to look for a forward. I don't know.
Really important here because they don't pick again until 118th. That's in the fourth round. So this pick is really key for the Pittsburgh Penguins.
That's right. No second and no third round pick. And again, they lost in heartbreaking fashion. There's Berkey. And to the New York Rangers in 7 games in the first round, having held a 3-1 series lead. In fact, they've only had one first-round pick, guys, since 2014. Sam Poulin back in 2019 as the Penguins take the stage.
But I love that, though. They're saying, you know what, we're in it to win it every year. So they're trading away their first pick. They're acquiring assets that are going to help them win now. And anytime you have Sidney Crosby, you're always in that win-now mode. Good on the Pittsburgh Penguins, regardless of who's the general manager there, for going down that road continuously.
All right, well, we're waiting to hear their pick. Ron Hextall, the GM, is expected to make the announcement. And they sit in the 21 spot. We were just mentioning Colby Armstrong. He was taken 21st overall by the Penguins back in 2001. Here's Ron Hextall.
To announce our first pick, three-time Stanley Cup champion and Montreal native Chris Letang.
Bonsoir Montréal. Merci beaucoup pour l'hospitalité. Les Penguins de Pittsburgh sont fiers de repêcher. The Pittsburgh Penguins are proud to select Owen Pickering.
Awesome. Look at that. Got the bow tie. I love it.
Owen Pickering, a left-handed shot D-man, swift current from the WHL, and another Manitoba player selected, and he joins his cousin as well, which is a great story, Matejchuk, who went a little earlier in this draft. So a big night right now for the WHL and a great night for Owen Pickering.
Well, I think about the Swift Current Broncos. In 2018, they did everything to go and win a WHL title. Manny Viveros was the head coach and the general manager at that time. They went all in. It worked. They won the championship. They didn't get it done in the Memorial Cup, but that took its toll. And if I had a general manager, a head coach change since then, Chad Leslie has come in there, and this guy has done unbelievable things. This 2004-born age group for the Swift Current Broncos, this is not the last we're going to hear of this group here tonight. Owen Pickering is the first. You got Josh Davis, you got Matthew Ward. There's a whole bunch coming, most likely on day two. This guy's the centerpiece of it all, and it's interesting. In his Bantam draft year, guy's 5'9". Now, he can kiss a street lamp. He's that tall.
Yeah, he is 6'4". All right, let's send it down to Kyle.
Well, David, we had Carolyn in the pre-show interviewing Pickering, Geeky, and Matejchuk, the three Manitoban boys, and they alluded to the fact that they all played baseball together. Once upon a time, they were all here in Montreal representing Team Manitoba at the U13 National Baseball Championships. Who could have imagined then that all three would be back in the same city years later, all selected in the first round of the National Hockey League entry draft, David?
It's really a great story, right? Right, we're 21 picks in. We have 5 picks from the WHL, the Western Hockey League. We have 5 picks from Sweden. That's leading the parade so far to the podium.
Carolyn and I met him last night at a function, and it was a great story. He said, is at the combine, and I'm thinking about my weight, right? Because he's a sleight of frame, right? He's so single, his eyes are skinny, single file. But anyways, he's sitting there, and he's saying, I'm pounding water left, right, and center, like 3 liters. Like, I got to go to the washroom. I throw my phone in my pocket before I get on the scale. He hits 180. He hopped off that scale in a hurry, and down the road he went just to get to that 180 mark. So really cool how this young man, he knows what he's got to do. He's got to eat. He's got to put on some weight. He'll get more strength, but I can guarantee this. He'll be committed to doing all of those things with being a great player so far.
Well, that smile says it all. They're enjoying this out in Manitoba. We're enjoying this, guys. Fans in the building for the first time in 3 years, and they're loving it so far. Much more coming up. You are watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal on Sportsnet. As always, hydrated by BioSteel.
What? With the newest member of the Pittsburgh Penguins, you're taking a look at yourself in the monitor in that jersey. What does this mean to you to wear this jersey and have Chris Letang be the one to greet you on stage?
It means the world. Can't put it into words. When he was announcing the pick and I heard my name, he kind of just blacked out. So, super special moment.
I feel like Brian Burke might have had a look at your photo album as a kid, because I want to show you a picture. There you are in the hard hat. Is this what Pittsburgh's getting, a hard-working defenseman?
I guess so, yeah. That's funny. I don't know why you guys brought that up, but hard-working.
Putting time in the basement, just like Sidney Crosby as a kid,
yeah, exactly.
Right?
2 years old, shooting it around. That's funny.
With Geeky and Matejchuk too, of course, your cousin. You're going to three Manitoba boys in the first round. What's it mean to you to share this moment with them, and you're going to be in the same division as Denton in Columbus?
Yeah, it means the world. You kind of look at our province, and it's a big day for Hockey Manitoba, so super proud, and it was nice to watch those guys kind of have their moments, and super excited.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
We're going to take a look at Owen Pickering here from Swift Current. Tall, rangy, real good stick, real good vision, outlets the puck very well. Not just a one-trick pony, he can shoot it from range and sees the ice back door on the power play. There's a little bit of work to do with him. I wish he could be a little bit more aggressive, as we're seeing right here all the time. But there's so much to work with here, Sam, with that foundation to build upon. Huge ceiling.
When you think about from 14 to 18, you go from 5'9", and all of a sudden you're like a 6'4 guy. Like, that's a lot to deal with, so you're not used to your body. And I think once you add the weight and you realize you can start to push people around a little bit, that will start to enter his game, especially as he gets stronger.
Let's move to the Anaheim Ducks, the 22nd pick coming their way.
Mason McTavish, who was our third overall pick last year, will make our selection.
The Anaheim Ducks are proud to select Nathan Gauthier from the Quebec Hockey League.
Mason McTavish making the pick. Nathan Gauthier, and yes, the QMJHL represented finally at the draft from the Quebec Remparts. 6'3", 207-pound center going to Anaheim. What's the scouting report here on Nathan Gauthier?
He's one of those players who's reliable in all situations. He's a guy that's not going to be a massive point producer, but a guy you need on your team to be able to play in all situations. He had 5 shorthanded goals this year. That led the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League. You can rely on the PK. He's defensively responsible, 59% in the faceoff circle with the Remparts. Playing for Patrick Roy is not always easy because he requires the most out of everybody on every single night. But when it comes to Gauthier, you talk about that type of reliable player. Those are key players to have in your lineup. Yes, we're not talking about a guy. It's interesting because in the scouting world, you say he's going to play. He's going to be one of those guys who's going to play. But you're not going to lean on him to be that high producer for you. But you know you're going to need him in order to win games because of how responsible he is.
There's a little bit of Braden Shen in him, Jason.
Yeah, that's a great example. And you know what I think of when I think of Anaheim and this player? He's not going to be Ryan Getzlaf, so I don't want to mislead anybody. But this is a guy, a big body, that provides leverage in battles. So where he's not really creative off the rush to make real saucer-type passes and things like that, he provides leverage, extends a play, goes to a hard area, gets the puck back. He's a goal scorer more than a distributor. There's a lot of these little intricacies in his game that bring immense value to team results.
He's been around it. His dad, Yannick, is the general manager in Rouen. So he's been around the game. His older brother went through the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League as well. But this is the type of player where you're saying, all right, he doesn't have that huge ceiling, but we know he's going to play.
It is definitely in the blood with so many of the picks we see here. It's really, there's a lineage there, right? It's the cultivation of the talent and some great pedigree. You mentioned his brother Jacob, captain of Baie-Comeau, father Yannick, a Quebec League scout as well. So incredible moment here for Nathan Gauthier and his family in his home province getting selected. It's going way far away, though. He's heading to the West Coast to the Anaheim Ducks. Does Jeff Merrick have anything to add?
No, I'm always fascinated with the Anaheim Ducks. You know, they have such a deep prospect pool at every single position. I don't know if there's a team that, well, develops defensemen better than the Anaheim Ducks. And you look down the middle, the future of the Anaheim Ducks is really bright. You already have Trevor Zegras there. We just saw Mason McTavish. I know Dallas Eakins is thrilled to have him in the lineup as early as next season as well. And now you throw Nathan Gauthier in the mix. It's like, this is their center core for the next 10 seasons. It's cut, it's print. And then you throw players like, you know, defenseman Olin Zellweger into the mix. You guys mentioned Drew Helison involved in the Josh Manson deal from earlier. You look at what this organization has been able to do, not just identify, but draft and develop. It is an elite crop of prospects that this Anaheim Ducks team can boast. And from a prospect's point of view, this team is the envy of the NHL. Here's Gauthier with Carolyn Cameron. Oh, sorry, we're standing by. Let's go back to David.
All right, well, he'll be there in a matter of moments. They're usually pretty quick. Maybe they don't like all the fashion questions. They're getting a little nervous. She's bringing out the old kid photos and stuff. They're a little nervous to set onto the stage. But we can tell you, Ron Hextall, who made a pick just moments ago, is standing by with our Elliot Friedman. Elliot.
Well, you have Chris Letang up there, a righty. You just drafted a lefty. Is this your future defense combo?
Makes sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Let's hope they sign Tanger, a long-term deal. Hopefully Owen's playing with him at some point here.
What did you like about him? What did you like about Pickering?
We actually like his trajectory this year. You know, he started off, and we met with him yesterday. Not long ago, he was 5'9", and now he's 6'4", and we feel like he's going to put on a lot of weight. We like his two-way game. We like his skills, and we just think there's a lot of upside.
All right, as you mentioned, you got Letang done today. Got to ask, Malkin, anything going on there?
We're hoping. We're certainly working away at it, and now we've got a little bit more clarity salary cap wise with Tanger in there. So hopefully the next step is getting Gino done.
Thanks very much, Ron.
Thank you.
Guys,
all right, Elliot putting the GMs on the hot seat, Carolyn Cameron putting the players on the hot seat. Go ahead, Carolyn.
No one's afraid. We've got Nathan. Nathan, you grew up just across the river. Oh, what does it mean to stand on this stage in this city?
It's unbelievable. I'm living like 30 minutes away from here. All the family's here, 60 people. We could hear them yell. It was just unbelievable.
Patrick Waugh is your coach with the Remparts. What's the best piece of advice he's given you?
It's just being myself. He's taught me so much about just being a pro every day, come into the rink and just be ready for the next level. So he's been huge for me.
Well, congratulations. Good luck in Anaheim.
Thank you.
Sam?
You know, what's interesting is he's so aware that we're talking about Gauthier, but I just want to go back to Pickering and talk about Hextall a little bit. And that Pickering pick was, he compared himself to Travis Sanheim, taking the exact point in the Western Hockey League draft, 9th, 177th overall. Here he is as a first rounder like Sanheim was all those years back, who went 17th overall. Same sort of height, same sort of growth potential, same sort of trajectory that Hextall talked about. And it's just amazing how aware these young guys are these days. He says, I'm the next Travis Sanheim. And he's right so far. Still got a ways to go to prove it, but he's right to this point when it comes to Owen Pickering. I think it's a real cool comparison.
I'm sure that Hexy brought it up in one of their interviews. You remind me so much of Travis Sanheim. And then the guy goes to YouTube and he says, now I know who Travis Sanheim is.
Hey, it is a copycat league, right? And GMs probably take a little bit of fact into the matter of, like, this guy's familiar to me, and that gives me some comfort. St. Louis Blues, they are ready to make their selection. They've made the playoffs 10 of the last 11 years. Of course, they lost in the second round to Colorado in 6 games this year. Their last 3 first selections out of the CHL, 2 from the Q.
With the 23rd selection, the St. Louis Blues are pleased to select Jimmy Snuggerud, NTDP.
So it's Jimmy Snuggerud, the 5th pick from the U.S. National Team Development Program. And here's someone a lot of teams were very, very high on. All the things I read leading up to this draft was such great ceiling for this guy. His dad, Dave, the 265 NHL games under his belt in the 1990s. And he says that his role model, guys, is Brock Besser of the Vancouver Canucks. Interesting.
Adam Nightingale, the head coach in the U.S. Under-18 program, said this has been our most improved guy going back to the start of when he entered the program with the Under-17. He has really come a long way, and around the net, absolutely brilliant. Magic hands. He can pick up rebounds. He's good at tips, deflections. He's good at finding that open space and that soft ice right around the net. That's where he excels in his game. You need goal scoring. He fits the bill of the St. Louis Blues, a little bit taller, a little bit heavier, exactly what Doug Armstrong was drafting when they won the Stanley Cup a few years back.
He'd love to be Bob Motzko, the coach at the University of Minnesota. Uh-huh. Logan Cooley went 3rd overall. Now Snuggerud's got 23rd overall. Those guys are going to be line mates at the University of Minnesota next year. It's going to be unbelievable to watch.
Heck of a
Snuggerud
problem.
Is a legitimate big-time shooter. That's his calling card. You can really shoot. David, you made a good point before. A lot of teams want him. Look at the team that's picking at 24, Minnesota. He's a native son.
Yeah, taken right from under them. Meanwhile, let's get down to the floor. Kyle has something to add.
Okay, David. Well, Nick Fora, assistant coach with the U18 at the U.S. program this past season, he said of Jimmy Snuggerud, so the first couple weeks when they were at the program together, when they were U17, they had a skills day on the ice, and he noted this kid at the far end of the rink shooting puck after puck, and it gave him flashbacks of when Austin Matthews was with the program. And Nick said, not comparing the style, how he plays to how Jimmy plays, but just the release gave him severe flashbacks of Austin Matthews. So St. Louis has a real shooter on their hands, it seems, Dave.
What I really like about this player, guys, is there's some centermen in the league that aren't necessarily goal scorers. They're distributors. And he's not necessarily going to be the guy that transports the puck up ice a lot. But when you are a good passer in the middle of the ice and you get this kid the puck and he sniffs out a little bit of ice and a little bit of net to shoot it, it's going in the net. Like, that is his element. You got to score goals. I keep coming back to it, but this guy's an elite shooter. You get it to him in the right area, the puck's in the net, and you can count on it.
Well, Leafs Nation, get ready, because Kyle Dubas is set to make a Leaf pick in 2 picks from now. The Leafs are picking, the Habs are picking. You're watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft on Sportsnet. Welcome back to the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal on Sportsnet, hydrated by BioSteel. Bill Guerin, guys, he's going to be back on the podium.
They had the 19th pick. They took Liam Ogren, and they're going to have the 24th pick in a matter of moments. But first, Jimmy Snuggerud standing by with our Carolyn Cameron. Carolyn.
Jimmy, the best moments are always shared. How special is tonight, considering you get to take part with a lot of your U.S. teammates?
Yeah, it's super cool to see them get picked, too, and just have those guys as teammates here. It's been super fun, you know, watch guys go up to the podium, and now hopefully watching more guys come up soon. So it's been really fun.
Speaking of shared moments, you're the third generation in your family after your dad and your grandfather to don the blue, red, and white. What does that mean to you?
It means a lot just to be able to play there and know that I'm a third generation Gopher. I think I'm the second ever, so it'll be super fun, you know, play there and play for the Gophers. So,
well, congratulations and best of luck.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, Carolyn. And again, a big night so far for the U.S. developmental team because many, many prospects have been chosen from there. Minnesota Wild, you know, it's funny, and we see Bill Guerin ready to go up to make the pick, and Pierre made a great point. Maybe that guy was snatched out from under them. So they're now on the clock making their second pick of the first round. Any thoughts here, gentlemen?
They make hard decisions. He's come in there, he's jettisoned a couple of contracts, some of the old leadership group, changing the guard. Like, he's getting after it. And I love a guy who walks into a job, not afraid to take risks. He's been trained by a lot of really good general managers along the way. Now he's got his own ship to run, and I love the way he's running it. And doesn't care what anyone else says about it.
It didn't hurt that he had Kaprizov to start with, though.
Oh, yeah, that was a great starting point. No, no doubt.
Get him over.
He's fifth round by, over there pick, got by him. The way. Yeah,
that was by Chuck Fletcher's regime, but they battle hard to get this guy. There's no question. That's a big part of their team.
I just love the moxie that he comes to the table with.
Agreed.
This is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to change it, and here we're doing it right now.
Here we go.
With the 24th selection, the Minnesota Wild, they're proud to select from Magnitogorsk of the KHL, Danila Yurov.
Jason, you've been talking at length about Danila Yurov, who's the 24th pick. What can you tell us about him?
Well, without disrespecting the other top 10 picks in this draft, it's a special day for everybody. This player is a legit top 6 player in this draft. That's how good he is. He's got elite offensive talent. He's not easy to play against. He extends plays, makes plays on his own. I mean, he does absolutely everything offensively that the NHL teams, and he's got the white shoes. That's two white shoes tonight, guys. That's awesome. It's like, I mean, this is an elite pick, and to your point, Sam, Bill Guerin, they've got Kaprizov there, so they've got some pedigree in place to hopefully bring a Russian over without fear, but I love the fact that he went out and did this.
You know what else? He's not just offense. This guy can play defense. Like, he plays all three zones, and he plays them really, really well. He might even be better in the NHL as a centerman than as a winger. He's a tremendous talent.
What do we talk about? Teams that would be eligible to do it. We looked at Tampa, we looked at Detroit, we looked at Washington, but he also looked at teams with multiple picks. This is the second first-round pick for Minnesota. So there is some risk, obviously, involved in this pick, but when you've already got a player that you really like at 19 in Ogren, now you can be a little bit more risk-taking in this venture.
These are two. Minnesota's done a real good job here with 19 and 24. These are two real players.
Now, Bill Guerin has done a great job, as you guys mentioned, in making tough decisions. Like the Kevin Fiala trade was a tough decision, right? They got him... another pick.
And Brock Faber, the player they got, he's at the University of Minnesota, and he's a big-time guy, too.
Let's send it down to the podium. Commissioner Gary Bettman, it looks like a trade has just happened.
We have a trade to announce. The Toronto Maple Leafs trade Peter Mrazek and pick number 25, which will be the next pick in this year's draft, to the Chicago Blackhawks for pick number 38 in this year's draft. So Toronto trades Mrazek and pick 25 to the Blackhawks for pick 38.
All right, so Chicago will be on the clock right now. And something with Chicago and the Canadian teams, right? They've made trades now with Ottawa, with Montreal, and with Toronto.
But how about this?
Yes.
Let's go back to last year's trade deadline. You remember what happened there? Fleury, that whole situation, and Kyle Dubas was not at all happy with Kyle Davidson that time because he felt that the trade got leaked out and that there was some potential at that time to bring Fleury to Toronto. When that didn't happen, you had to wonder if those two were ever going to talk again. But when you're sitting there and you need to make your team better, you know you need to get out of that cap salary issue that the Toronto Maple Leafs have. This is a way to do it, yet they still get a pick in an area where they probably get a player they like.
So are they freeing up money? They don't have Jack Campbell as a UFA. They don't have a goalie right now. Peter Mrazek and Jack Campbell, are they freeing up money? And if so, for who? Because Fleury signed today in Minnesota.
I don't know if so for who, but maybe Ville Husso, who's going to be a free agent. But I talked to Jason about this just before we came back on air. They're freeing up money. I don't know who it's for, but I might think maybe Ville Husso.
Well, I'm going to throw Kemper into that mix too, I guess, to be determined at another show next week. Be with us, Pierre. This is a little bit of a surprise for me. I didn't think that Mrazek was going to be a tradable asset in any type of scenario. I thought he was a buyout candidate. So this is a win for Toronto. This is a win because they're in win now mode and they free up some cash.
You know, and Chicago got rid of some money today with getting rid of Alex DeBrincat and his $6.5 million cap, the $9 million in cash. So there was some space for Kyle Davidson to do things. Man, these young guys come in there and they start firing, don't they?
Yes.
Wow.
So we're not going to hear from the Maple Leafs until tomorrow unless something changes with the last five picks, because they've moved their only first-round pick, number 25, to Chicago for the 38th pick. But again, it's moving that salary of Peter Mrazek.
The cap space costs something, and it costs them a first-round pick.
All right, let's get back down to the draft floor. We'll have more on the Maple Leafs in a little while. But first, Bill Guerin and Elliot Friedman.
Take us through your two first-round picks.
Well, to be honest with you, I really listen to our scouts. And you know what? There are just two guys that we had in our top 11 picks on our list. And we feel very fortunate that we got them where we did. So it's been a really good first round for us.
Big day for you today, too. You got Fleury done. Was there ever any question you were going to get it done?
Yeah, that was a big one to get Fleury done today. And just add him back into the mix. He's a really important piece for us. Him and Cam Talbot are going to be a fantastic tandem back there, and got all the confidence in the world in our goaltending.
All right, and just finally, Kaprizov, any clarity on just his situation?
No, we're just not commenting on anything like that.
Okay. Thank you, Bill.
Yeah, thanks, Elliot.
Guys.
All right, thank you for that, Elliot. And for those wondering about Peter Mrazek's contract, he's owed $3.8 million this year and $3.8 million next year, so a pretty big salary move by the Maple Leafs as they move down 14 slots. They'll be picking 38th. Meanwhile, Chicago's heading to the podium. What about Kyle Davidson? I mean, you talk about tough decisions with Bill Guerin. This guy's made three massive trades today.
Yeah, it's unbelievable just to think that you're his first time in the job. I know he's been mucking in the weeds going back to 2010 and some of their cup runs, but now he gets an opportunity to put his stamp on the Chicago Blackhawks franchise, and boy, did he ever put a stamp on it.
He is certainly not afraid. Doc traded, DeBrincat traded, and they bring in Mrazek as they move up a third first-round pick now coming for the Chicago Blackhawks. Let's hear what they're going to do with that pick. They already picked at the 7 and the 13th spot so far tonight.
Chicago Blackhawks are proud to select from Chaska High School in Minnesota, Sam Rinzel.
The 8th D-man taken, Sam Rinzel, out of Minnesota, and high school player, guys. You don't see that very often, a high school player. It's interesting. What do you make of this pick?
Right shot D, 6'4", 177 pounds, a lot of rawness to his game, and it is really difficult to judge high school players. Having said that, when you just look at the raw tools in and of themselves, you have to be impressed at what he's able to bring to the table. He's a guy who's not afraid to bang bodies. Yes, he can jump up and produce offensively, although against that lower competition, he's really a man amongst boys playing in high school. But you think so highly of your scouting staff with their ability to project forward that you go ahead, you make the pick a little bit off the board. Some mock drafts had him maybe in the late stages of the first round, and so Chicago's saying, you know what, we're doing it, and we're doing it quickly.
He's going to go play for the Waterloo Blackhawks in the USHL this year, and then not this coming year, but the next year, he's going to the University of Minnesota. So another one of those guys going to the University of Minnesota.
But that year at Waterloo is going to be huge for his
gigantic
development. I mean, he's going against players that are going to be older than him. They're going to be as strong as he are, some as big as he are. He's not going to be able to have his way and apply himself the way he did in high school, but based on the projection and based on that body of work that he put in high school, you think that he might be able to adjust quickly?
Agreed.
Well, one of the things that I look at when I'm scouting a player like this is his projection. When you look at his numbers at Chaska at the high school level, those aren't elite offensive numbers. And you would hope that they would be a little bit higher. Here's the thing. He's not going to be that in the NHL, and I'm okay with that. He's a 6'4" body. He's going to fill out a little bit more. He'll transport the puck. I'm good with that, but I don't expect him to run your power play. I don't need that out of this body as he matures to be a pro, and it's going to be interesting, Pierre. His timeline, going to Waterloo, then going to college, we're looking 3-4 years down the road. Because they pick up these extra picks, they're comfortable with that development timeline.
You know, you look at the two defensemen. They had Korchinski from Seattle. They had Renzel, who's going to Waterloo. Chicago's trying to rebuild
that
defense.
Blue line. And yeah, they got a right-handed shot and a left-handed shot as well, Pierre. It's also worth noting, Renzel played high school hockey with Jimmy Snuggerud. So, like, it's funny. This U.S. development program, you know, they start him young. Look at the face, right? Like, this is a young kid. Smiles all around out of high school and now possibly into the NHL. As you said, though, it's going to be a little bit of development before we see him in the National Hockey League. By the way, Montreal Canadiens, they're on the clock next. So a second pick coming from Montreal Canadiens. This place is about to get loud here in Montreal.
Elite skating ability for this young man. That's the great foundation to his game. When you talk about the projection, I mean, everyone has to skate. Sam Renzel is an elite skater.
I totally agree with that.
And there is the crowd.
Oh, I love it. They've been engaged all night. This has been great.
You know, and we missed this over the last 2 years. I felt bad for the draft picks the last 2 years. Doing it over a Zoom call, like we've all had meetings over Zoom calls, it's just not the same. We're social people, and you want to be face-to-face. And this moment is so different. I mean, look at the excitement here as they anticipate the 26th pick of this draft coming to the Montreal Canadiens. Any thoughts on that pick, by the way, gentlemen?
I'm fascinated here, and again, we're seeing another general manager in his first go-around really make a big splash. I don't know if there's a big splash left on the table here.
Well, what about his son?
Jack Hughes.
Yeah, do you want a splash? If they get Jack Hughes, that would be the greatest story of the night, I'd have to think.
Pretty stoic-looking group over there right now.
Jack saying, come on, Dad. Here's the thing, in the interview, when you interview with your father, who's the GM, what do you say? I have really great parents, I had a really good upbringing.
Something tells me Marty LaPointe did that interview and there was no Kent Hughes in the room.
No, actually, Kent went in the room. He was about to leave and they asked him to come back in and stay there and be in the room just to give a little bit of that uncomfortability and see how the young man would react.
All right, we have Sam Renzel, I believe, standing by with Caroline Cameron. So let's go down there and take a listen.
Well, Sam, you gave your family a big hug, and I guess you have your dad to thank. Explain the story of how he got you into hockey.
Yeah, I think just when I was younger, kind of around preschool or kindergarten, you know, he'd just kind of take me out to lunch, and we'd go to this little 3-on-3 rink, and I would learn to skate there. And I think that's kind of where my first memory of hockey started and, you know, where it all began. So.
And early memories are with Jimmy Snuggerud, who was picked just 2 picks ago. What do you remember of winning the Pee Wee State Championship?
It was a blast. I mean, being able to win that, you know, even when you're really young like that, it's pretty special. And I think to do it with him and to experience this with him, too, is pretty cool. So,
well, congratulations and enjoy tonight.
Thank you.
All right. You got to love the smiles. They look great in the uniform. So much work to still do. I mean, the dream is realized, but, you know, the real hard work, honestly, I guess, begins now because cutting into the National Hockey League is no easy task. And, you know, Jason, you worked in player development and hockey ops and everything else and amateur scouting. You know, how do you get the guy from this part of you know, the process to that next part, getting him out on the ice as an NHLer?
The first thing you do if you're in my role as a director of scouting is you get out of the way. That's the very first thing. All the best NHL teams right now have outstanding player development departments. In Florida, we had Brian McCabe there. Roberto Luongo's heading up to goaltending now over there. You just get out of the way. For a kid like this, though, Sam Renzel, you have to get it into him that this is going to be a long journey. The work that has to be put into this in the next 3 years for you is going to have to, you're going to have to go to a level that you're not accustomed to, and the message will get through to character kids.
Yeah. It's taken a little while for teams, I feel, to really invest a lot in their player development. We used to be one guy, and he'd travel around, he'd say hello, and maybe have a beer with his old buddies. It's taken a long time for teams to realize you don't have to spend a lot of money to be able to get a lot of use out of these guys. And a lot of players, just like everybody else, they want love. They want you to go in there and see him and say hello and take him for lunch and get out on the ice with him. That's what players need in order to develop. They want to know that they're being cared for. It's really come a long way in the last 5 years, player development.
Real quick before this pick happens, almost every team has player development in Europe now as well. It's just not in North America.
That's great to hear. That.
International draft indeed. Montreal back on the podium. I'm hoping they pick Jack Hughes. Just me. I love those stories. Let's hear what the Montreal Canadiens have to do in front of the home crowd.
Les Canadiens de Montréal sont fiers de sélectionner de la Ligue élite de Slovaquie, Philippe Méchard.
So it's Philip Massar, a right winger out of Slovakia, and of course Slovakians taken both first and second overall, and this is now a hat trick of players taken in this draft.
And this is clearly a result of what we've been talking about and the emergence of the Slovakian program. Here he is coming down the off wing, and a guy who makes good plays. You see him just extend beyond all the checks. All right, I'm going to go back against the grain and fire. There's Meshar. He's just hanging out, waiting around. Good job there. Push the puck ahead. Get it out of everyone's way. It's okay. I can do it on the backhand, too. My skill set, my hands allow me to do just about everything. And again, going to the backhand, really confident there, thinking a little bit about Sidney Crosby, a two-time world junior player, kind of snuck under the radar. A lot of people had him going towards the end of the first round, which is that exactly where he ends up. And he's got a buddy who went a little earlier to come and hang out with.
100%. You know what? He's not an overly large person, got a good body, but he's a game breaker. That's the kind of player that he is.
I agree. His ceiling could be Thomas Kokanik-like, you know, for Montreal people who are not as much aware of the player. That could be his ceiling. A little bit off the puck detail that you're always going to want more out of, but explosive, quick strike offensive skill.
How's this for a stat? Matt, our great stat guy, just handed me this. Slovakia, first round picks in the last 10 years total, one. Three tonight. Unbelievable what's happening there.
And it is. And Craig Ramsey is a big part of that. I mean, let's go play, guys. Let's go score goals. Let's use our skill. We can skate as good as the Canadians or the Americans or the Russians. We have the hands. We have the skill set as good as the Canadians and the Americans and the Russians. So why are we sitting back and playing not to lose? Let's go out and play to win hockey games. These three young guys have really done a great job in pushing that thing forward. Now, Meshar didn't get a chance to play in the World Championships like the other two in Nemitz and in Slavkovsky. This will come in due time for him, and the national team program in Slovakia will be better off because of it.
Let's check in with Jeff Merrick. Do we have Merrick? Oh, all right, sorry. Jeff, we'll get back to Jeff Merrick in a little while. Anything to add on this pick from the Canadians? Because we have the San Jose Sharks going to be making a selection in a few minutes.
You know what? Again, I love the risk at 26. Anytime you can continue to add elite offensive upside type players at this slot, it's worth the risk. There's going to be some warts to his game, but the electricity wins out.
And 14 picks again, the most that any NHL team has had since the Chicago Blackhawks. I mean, they're going to be up early and often, Jeff Gorton and the gang. We're going to send it down now to Jeff Merrick. Oh, sorry, to Carolyn.
That's okay. And Philip, what a night for you and Slovakia. What does it mean to share this, to be reunited with Slavkovsky and share it with Nemec?
Yeah, it's a pretty cool night. Everything is kind of crazy. First two guys, Slovaks. Now I am third. I'm going to Montreal with you, right? So I really like that. And yeah. Very good night today.
Uri actually said that you are, quote, going to be a beast one day. How do you take that?
Yeah, maybe one day I will be. But I think Uri will be like a better beast than me. I am like a little skill guy, you know, and technical guy. So maybe I will be like kind of that guy.
Okay, we'll quote you on that. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
You have to love that. That's a great sound right there. A littler beast, a smaller beast, maybe. A skilled guy. He knows who he is. He's a skilled guy.
That's fantastic. You see how excited he is to be with his buddy, though? I mean, it's just great to see these stories come out. You know, what's happened with the Russian players. Mirzhnichenko, a really cool story. Slavkovsky is balling her eyes out. The McGroarty family. What a great night this is to watch all the reactions and see the culmination of all that work, money, time, effort spent to come here tonight. I love seeing it.
There's a name on the board, guys, that's intriguing, and I'm almost feeling bad for him a little bit at this point. Brad Lambert was projected to be a potential top five pick in this draft, and here we are going into pick 27, and crickets, right? We haven't really heard his name around our circles very much, so it's going to be interesting here in the next, if it doesn't happen tonight, in the next 10 picks, for example, to see if Brad Lambert's name is called.
What's happened there? Well, can you explain it?
It's lack of production is really what it comes down to. I mean, if you go back to 15 points in 46 games in Liga, as a double underage, you thought, all right, he's on the path upward. He goes to the World Juniors, he's pretty good. You go to the under 18s, not so much. And then the same thing happens again. But then you see him in the two games at the World Juniors this year. He puts up 5 points. He's absolutely electric. He is lighting it up. I think switching teams in Finland was a little bit problematic. You worry about some of the background noise when that happens. In a vacuum as a hockey player, this guy has the skill set to be a top six player. But all of the noise and the lack of production has really set him back. And he reminds me so much of Aturatu, who we saw last year. When you go back to his double underage year, he was projected to be a top five pick. He ended up going 52nd or 53rd to the Islanders. This gentleman, Brad Lambert, might be in that very same spot.
All right, gentlemen, it's with heavy hearts, I'm sure, that the San Jose Brass are going up to the podium. Brian Marchman, of course, passed away, 14-year NHL vet, a scout with the organization. We want to send our condolences to his family, his wife Kim, children Logan and Mason, who plays with the Florida Panthers. And here's Mike Greer, the newly hired GM of the San Jose Sharks.
Thank you, Montreal. You guys have been wonderful hosts this week. I'd like to congratulate Joe Sakic and the Colorado Avalanche. Before we make our selection, on behalf of the Marchman family and the San Jose Sharks organization, I want to express our sincere thanks for the outpouring of love and support that we have received over the last 24 hours in response to the sudden loss of our beloved friend and colleague, Brian Marchman. As most of you know, Brian loved the game of hockey. He absolutely loved it. He breathed it. He used it. No one was happier to be at the rink than Mush. His opponents may not have enjoyed playing against him, but as someone who was his teammate, I can tell you that there was no one I would rather go into battle with or who you would want on the bench than Brian. Brian's reputation on the ice was that of a fierce, relentless competitor. But off the ice, he was honest, down to earth, loving, and he truly cared about people. You could tell this by the way he engaged with everyone, the questions he asked, and the time he spent with you as a person. The imprint that he has left on his teammates during his 17-year NHL career, the Sharks prospects who he has mentored and helped develop, and on his colleagues, both inside and outside of the Sharks organization, will be felt well into the future. Tonight, we again send our most heartfelt condolences to all of Brian's family and friends, but particularly his parents, John and Joanne, his siblings, Wayne, Carrie, and Tara, and especially his wife, Kim, his children, Mason and Logan. We love you, Brian. You will be missed, but you will never be forgotten. To make our first round selection is our Director of Scouting, Doug Wilson, Jr.
The San Jose Sharks are proud to select from Linköping center Philip Bystad.
Well, that was a beautiful statement from the newly minted GM, Mike Greer, remembering Brian Marchman and what he meant to the NHL community and to the Sharks community specifically. And once again, we pass on our condolences to their family. And I think Mike Greer said it best at the end, guys. gone but not forgotten. He's left a very indelible mark in hockey. And I know someone you knew quite well, Sam.
Loving was the thing that came out to me. And you didn't know him. You watched the play. You thought, oh, no, that he can't be a very nice man. And then when you sit down, you meet him, you have a beer with him, he is so engaged in the conversation. He's so interested in you and what your family's doing. It's not just about hockey. It's not just about I was a 17-year NHL player. He invested in every conversation he had with people, and he loved being at the rink. And every time you saw him, he just brought a smile to your face. Got to travel with him to a couple of different places when we'd end up in the same place together, and you'd always have a friendly beer and a handshake for him. And he is really going to be missed. And I know that San Jose Sharks organization was completely broken up because he was the glue in that scouting group, in that development group. He brought the front office together with the players. He was that type of guy, a loving guy. I love how Mike Greer really put that, and he'll be missed much.
Well said, Sam. There's no easy transition from, you know, talking about Brian Marchman to, you know, celebrating this moment for Philip Bystedt, and he deserves to have that moment celebrated. You know, he's living out his dream here as he goes 27th overall to the San Jose Sharks. What can you tell us, gentlemen, about Philip Bystedt?
Well, big body forward. He doesn't do anything elite. He does a lot of things well. And there's, I don't want to be Debbie Downer here, but this is a little bit of a project for me. He's not an elite scorer. He's not exceptionally quick off the rush. Now, having said that, with his size, I do project him to be a 3F, somebody that can lean on some people, hopefully open up a little bit more space for his line mates. He can defend efficiently, maybe penalty kill for you, but this is a long-term view that the San Jose Sharks are taking here.
Probably not as heavy as Nathan Gauthier, but a similar type player when you look at a projection of being 3F where you don't have that massive ceiling, but a guy that's reliable.
No, and the guy that they're going to probably try to hook him up with is William Eklund, who was their 17th overall last year. But no, this is a project player, saw him a fair bit, and listen, maybe that's what San Jose is about right now. They're not in a rebuild, but a retooling mode, and maybe that's where Philip fits there.
The 28th selection in the 2022 NHL Draft.
Well, the Sharks honoring Brian Marchment tonight at their draft table. Again, Brian Marchment, never forgotten by the hockey community. Welcome back to the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal on Sportsnet, hydrated by BioSteel. The Buffalo Sabres are prepared to make their third pick of the first round. However, once the Sabres are done, the Edmonton Oilers, Ken Holland and the gang, will have their first pick of the first round. And then the Winnipeg Jets are on deck after them with the 30th pick and their second of the first round. So look at your best available, Sam, and how do you see this shaking down in the next few minutes?
Well, it's really interesting. Isaac Howard had a great year with the U.S. Under 18 program. He's one of the guys that's been left over from that group that we've already seen there. Jagr Furkus, we talked about him off the top of the broadcast, 150 pounds, 30-plus goal scorer with the Moose Jaw Warriors, really slight of frame. A lot of different options here available to the Buffalo Sabres.
Well, so far, the Buffalo Sabres have done a really good job in this draft. I mean, Matt Savoy is an outstanding center iceman. Noah Osloon is a phenomenal playmaker, makes everybody around him better. I wonder if Buffalo goes with another centerman.
Well, they have their options wide open because I feel they're in a pretty good position right now. You got to kick it forward here with Power and Dahlin, and you look at Tage Thompson up front. You got Peyton Krebs, Dylan Cousins. It's really starting to be time to move that ball forward.
Matthew Savoy at 9, Noah Osland at 16, and now here they are, third time at the podium for Kevin Adams. And again, a team has missed the playoffs 11 straight years. They don't need one piece. They don't need two pieces. They need a lot of pieces. But remember, one thing you got to factor in, they have Owen Power, right? Oh, they're making the
28th pick. The Buffalo Sabres are proud to select from the Czech League, Jiří Kulek.
And as you suggested, another centerman. And again, losing Jack Eichel, now they've added three centermen in the first round tonight. And from Czechia, number 28 overall, Jiří Kulek.
And just remember, they got Jack Quinn coming, they got J.J. Paterka coming, they got Peyton Krebs is already there. These are all wingers. They need centermen with Eichel gone. So now they go Tage Thompson one, and everybody else is filling in.
They got Dylan Cousins there, and they just you wonder if Quinn is ever going to move back to the middle of the ice. He does have that potential.
Yuri Kulik's a pure shooter. I mean, here you're going to see him at the under-18 championships in Germany. He won the most valuable player of the tournament. Scores from range with a snapshot, beat you with a slapshot, finds quiet ice. I mean, he's all about getting pucks into the net. He's a finisher all day long. So if guys like Oslin in the future are extending plays and finding him in scoring areas, the puck's in the back of the net, guys.
He had nine goals in that tournament, and Canadian fans will remember him because he had a hat trick against Canada, including the OT winner.
Yeah, seven of those were on the power play, so he does have that specialty to his game. But you look at his nine goals in the Superliga, that's the third most all time for an under 18 player. And you're talking about Yuri Hudler. Yeah, you can debate his NHL career, but still a star over in Czechia. And you're talking about Sikora as well as the two ahead of him. So pretty heady stuff when you're able to score nine goals in the men's league, and it's only been done at a better rate by two others.
It's not just a scorer, though. He brings energy. Like, yes. He doesn't sit back and just say, get me the puck and I'll score. He can forecheck. He can create mayhem in the offensive zone. He's got good speed.
Eric.
He plays with a ton of energy.
The fascinating part to me, like, can one tournament make a difference? You were there. You saw the whole thing.
Oh, when he does what he did there, I'll tell you, my eyes were like well wide open, especially in a very unusual scouting cycle that we've gone through recently.
So one tournament can have that impact to move a guy?
Especially in this cycle coming out of COVID.
Right. Awesome.
All right, I'm going to give this a shot and see if Jeff Merrick has something to add from the draft floor.
Well, no, it's just that, you know, going into this draft, we looked at the Buffalo Sabres, and you guys have hit on a lot of the main points. If you have a look at the Buffalo Sabres on the back end, they are completely set right now. The big three is going to be there for a long time, and they're really starting to come together. And that trio includes Owen Power, who's going to play all year for the Buffalo Sabres, Rasmus Dahlin and Matias Samuelsson as well. But I think we went into this draft, much like Pierre was saying, look, Peyton Krebs, Jack Quinn, J.J. Paterka, these are all wingers. They need depth at center.
We have
they
a trade
identified
to
and they did something about it tonight.
The Edmonton Oilers trade Zach Cassian, pick number 29 in this year's draft, which is the next pick, Edmonton's third round pick in 2024, and Edmonton's second round pick in 2025 to the Arizona Coyotes for pick number 32 in this year's draft.
Wow. So Canadian teams once again getting involved. Edmonton trades the pick. We'll have much more on the Edmonton deal in just a matter of moments. And Arizona is actually on the clock right now, but we want to send it back down to the draft floor. Yuri Kulich standing by with our Carolyn Cameron.
Yuri, congratulations. You were MVP at the under-18s. How do you think that performance perhaps changed the minds of GMs and scouts?
I just enjoy it, yeah, and I'm so proud of that and grateful. I don't have much words.
Let's have you raise your mic a little bit. You get the jersey, you get the cap, but tell people why maybe you should have gotten a beanie.
Beanie?
Yeah, a beanie, because your last name in English
That's so cool, and I thought it was just a joke, but it's not a joke, and that was so great.
Okay, you'll need a beanie or a toque, because we call it here in Canada, for the Buffalo winter. So best of luck and congratulations.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you very much, Carolyn, and Yuri Kulich on his way to Buffalo. The Edmonton Oilers, maybe not a massive surprise, because just like the Leafs, they're trying to free up some money here, and they've done that by moving Cassian.
Cassian's got 2 years left on his deal, about $3.5 million per year, so they freed up some money.
You guys like this deal for Edmonton, then?
Well, they need it to free up some money.
The cost of it, though.
But that's a draft pick. We see what it costs to free up cap room. That's what it costs.
And that's right down Arizona's road. This is exactly what they've been planning to do, and they continue to execute it.
Well, they slide three picks. How big a difference is 29 to 32?
Well, for this year's draft, I think it's on par, to be honest with you. I don't see any difference between 29 and 32. So you're not going to feel the impact of the draft capital necessarily today, but going forward, there's a real possibility. And I just want to bring you guys back to our trade deadline discussions this year. There's a trend developing in the National Hockey League. These picks, 2, 3, 4 years out, are being traded out now. They're being traded out. And it's because of the cap situation. It never used to be like that, Pierre, right? It's like we've traded a player out for 1 year. That was like a big deal. Now we're 3 years out in the road.
Well, it's funny. I mean, listen, COVID did a number on the cap. The cap at this point might have been at $90 million, not $82.5 million. And that's a substantial difference. That $7.5 million can get you two or three decent players, and that they don't have the luxury of having that. So a lot of teams are thinking along those lines, right?
But that capital, too. When you think about when Arizona wants to be good 3 years down the road, you have that third-round pick in 2024. It will have some prominence then. And a second-round pick in 2025, likely... If you predict the future, those picks will be used to get assets to try and, they hope at that time, get them over the hump.
Let me cut you off just really quickly. I want to get down to the draft floor with Elliot Friedman.
That couldn't have been easy, but that was beautifully done.
Oh, thank you. It's been a tough couple of days for the organization and, you know, especially our scouting staff. You know, we all love Mutch, and those guys spend so much time with them preparing for the draft and on the road with them. So, it's really been a tough 24 hours, but I got to give the guys a lot of credit. They powered their way through it.
You can only imagine the excitement you had when you thought you started the night at number 11. Was it hard to trade down, considering, you know, it's your first real big challenge on the job?
Yeah, you know, it's always kind of tough to move out of those picks in the top half of the draft, but we thought that we were getting a lot of value and trying to build up our prospect pool again, so getting a couple extra pieces we thought was worth it.
Thank you very much, Mike.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, Elliot, Arizona making their third first-round pick of the night. At number 3, Logan Cooley. At number 11, Connor Geeky. Let's hear what they have at 29.
The Arizona Coyotes select Le Voltigeur de Drummondville, Maverick Lamoureux.
Well, Maverick Lamoureux, the second player taken out of the queue. In his home province, this is a beautiful scene. His father, Patrick, who played in the queue back in the 1990s. Oh, look at that. That's a nice scene right there. 6'7". You can't teach height, I understand. What can we expect from Maverick Lamoureux? By the way, that's a fantastic name. Kelly Rudy's grandson's name, Maverick. That's a fantastic, and it's a strong name.
Well, I mean, here's a guy who's really just starting to come into his own. You'd like to see him play a little bit more physical brand of hockey, but he's able to add some points. He moves pretty good for a big guy. He obviously has to put on some weight and strength. He can shoot at a ton. I think he's another one of those players that we talk about, Pickering or Sam Rinzel, that as he continues to grow into his body at 6'7", 197 already, you see a little bit of that in his game, you expect to see a lot more. And I got to tell you, Bill Armstrong's pretty predictable. We're going to take on bad contracts. We're going to get as many prospects as we can, and we're going to go with size. And he's done that. Other than Logan Cooley at 3, where he addressed the skill, you look at his pick after that, trading up to get Connor Geeky, and now this pick with Maverick Lamoureux. He definitely is going for the big body.
Oh, I know he's big, but I know another thing. He's really athletic, and that's really going to help that big body mature, Jason.
I have strong belief that the character of this kid, Sam, you and I spent a lot of time with him at the Combine. I really love the character. This kid's going to put in the work, and there's work to be done. There's absolutely work to be done. Hey, does anybody do it better than the NHL? The kid's crying on his way out to shake the commissioner's hand. It's a great night. This kid's a little bit of a project, but when you have as many picks as Arizona's had tonight, you can roll the dice.
He's a sore cheek guy. He always has a smile on his face. He walks into the rink, he's got a smile. He leaves the rink, he's got a smile. Even when he's crying, he's got a smile on his face. You love that character about this young man.
And a nice moment here in his home province as well, a special moment for his family. 6'7", one of the tallest players ever drafted into the National Hockey League.
Oh, look at that.
That's a beautiful ovation here in Montreal for the hometown boy.
That's really cool. He does some work on the side and in the offseason with Paul Boutelier, a defensive specialist coach who goes around and has a real good client base, keeps it quiet, doesn't really get in anyone's way. But I tell you, the detail in which he goes about his business and trying to teach his players about closing gaps, stick position, presence in front of the net, angling, all of these different things are things that he's going to be working on in the offseason as he continues to work with Paul Boutelier, who does an amazing job in that field.
Let's hear from Jeff Merrick.
You know, one of the things we also have to keep in mind about the Arizona Coyotes is what's happening with the rink situation in Tempe right now. And so far, they've jumped over all the hurdles. But make no mistake about it here, and you guys have mentioned it, Logan Cooley is going to University of Minnesota next year. That's going to be a dynamic program. Might be the best team in the United States at the college level. But if you have a look at all the players that they're drafting, all the players that they've traded for, and we think of a player like Jack McBain, we think of Nathan Smith, who came from Winnipeg in the Brian Little deal, everything in this program is structured to start peaking when that rink arrives. And for Arizona, the fingers are crossed that they'll get this thing over the finish line. Nothing is really going to happen for this team as far as prospects and young players in this organization for the next 3 to 4 years. That is very deliberate, and that is not accidental at all by the Arizona Coyotes. They're looking to peak when the arena gets open.
And that's a good point by Jeff Merrick, although that's funny. That's such a unique situation, guys, because what did we mention earlier on today? I think 21 of the 32 GMs have been hired in the last 5 years. Clearly, Bill Armstrong has a little bit longer leash to take things really rock bottom and build it up. And 3 picks in the first round, that's going to go a long way, I imagine, Pierre.
Well, absolutely. I would agree 100%, especially Logan Poole.
All right, let's send it down to Kyle.
All right, David, alongside Maverick's dad, Patrick. Patrick, I just heard you say, I think I might cry. Could you tell me what emotions are going through your mind right now?
It's been a long run. We've been thinking about this day. Maverick's been a hell of a kid. He's been working hard. We spent some nice and quality time with the Will Sports Group. They've been great with us, but right now the emotion is, I feel I'm going to cry. Probably not right now, but later on. Yeah.
I know you have a background in hockey yourself. When did you feel, you know, your son could potentially be taken in an NHL draft?
I played hockey, and Maverick is, I'll say he's way better than me. He's got Isabel's athleticism. He's such a great kid. He's working hard. I feel he's going to play like a super nice role with the Arizona Coyote. I think he's going to play physical. And there's a lot to say right now, but the emotions are overwhelming.
And what do you make of all this?
I'm really happy and proud of him.
Wonderful. Well, both of you, enjoy the night and the whole family. It's been wonderful to watch.
Thank you.
David.
Oh, that's beautiful. Patrick and Isabel must be so proud of their son. And I love the fact that Patrick said, yeah, it's his mom's athleticism. That's awesome.
She was comfortable going to the mic, too.
Yeah.
She was right on it.
It's great. And this is a family. This is a day for family. These pictures are what this day is about, right? You know, we cover the NHL all year long. There's trades, and it's a business. But this is sort of, you know, a celebratory night for so many families. And tomorrow it's going to be another 192 families celebrating like this. So it's really great to see.
Yeah, pretty awesome. Plays for Steve Hartley, Bob Hartley's son, in Drummondville. And he's done a good job bringing Maverick along.
Well, for the second time tonight, the Winnipeg Jets and Kevin Cheveldayoff are heading to the podium to make a pick. They picked at number 14. And that was Rutger McGroarty. And now, with the number 30 pick, we'll find out what the Winnipeg Jets have up their sleeves. Again, they missed the playoffs for the first time in 5 years, and a lot of question marks surrounding their other personnel. So a big moment here for Kevin Cheveldayoff and the Jets.
The Winnipeg Jets are proud to select, from the Lahti Pelicans in Finland, Brad Lambert.
All right, there he is, Brad Lambert. And we talked about him earlier, and you gentlemen said he had slipped, and at one point he was considered a top five prospect. So this is maybe a bittersweet moment. Right now he's quite excited, but it's been maybe a tougher journey to get to this point than others. But what do you guys think about Brad Lambert, who goes 30th to the Jets and has had this circuitous route to get to the podium tonight?
For me, when he was an underage, double underage at the Halyk Memorial in Slovakia a few years ago, he came on the radar. And he might have come on the radar a little bit too early because he had such a fantastic week. And the expectation, the bar was set very early for his trajectory. I'm really hoping that this kid can figure it out. I want to see a big smile here. You know, I feel like draftitis, I know it's not a real disease, but I feel like he had it, if you get my drift. Like, I felt like he felt the pressure of the world on him, and he lost the fun in the game. When he's on, fast, elusive, goal scorer, quick all over the ice. Let's hope he figures it out.
Do you leave him in Finland, or do you bring him over to play major junior hockey?
Well, it's interesting because the Saskatoon Blades just traded his rights in the Western Hockey League to Seattle, and Seattle's got a team that we've talked about a little bit already. Kevin Korchinski, they got Reed Schaefer, Jordan Gustafson. That would be a great group for hit into. Getting back with your own age group, putting the fun back into your game. Be a kid. Get a smile on your face. Enjoy coming to the rink every day. I think it's been more work for Brad Lambert lately than it has been fun.
so lucky to be able to play this game, to be healthy, to be in that situation, get back to having fun. And when he gets there, then I think we're going to see that guy we saw as a double underage.
And that's why I asked the question, because I think the smartest move for him right now is to leave Finland and go play in Seattle.
And an interesting background. His father, Ross, of course, is Canadian. His mother, Heli, is Finnish. And his uncle, because you know the name Lambert, Lane Lambert, of course, the head coach of the New York Islanders. So we have 30 picks in, 2 picks to go, our final 2 picks in just a matter of moments in the upper deck room. You're going to be seeing these gentlemen on hockey cards in the upcoming days as you're watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft, hydrated by BioSteel. Welcome back to the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal. And there's the walk from Julien Brisebois, 2-time Stanley Cup winner. And the Tampa Bay Lightning, the Eastern Conference champs, but fell short in the Stanley Cup final this year to the Colorado Avalanche. No shame in that, especially when we heard about the litany of injuries his team was suffering through during the playoffs. It's unbelievable that they made a run as deep as they did, including a run of 11 straight playoff series wins. Tampa Bay really at least a small D dynasty in my mind. And this is their highest pick since Cal Foote, who they took 14th overall back in 2017. So let's hear what Tampa Bay Lightning have to do tonight in Montreal.
Bonjour, Montreal. Merci beaucoup pour la hospitalité. With the 31st pick, Tampa Bay Lightning pleased to select Isaac Howard from the U.S. Development Program.
Oh, what do you think of that outlook? That outfit, hey?
I don't think he's going to wear that where he's going to college, Minnesota Duluth. I'll tell you
casual,
that.
Casual Fridays. It's from the Austin Matthews collection, maybe. Yeah.
Let's wait for the shoes. The shoes are going to determine the whole thing here.
I like
got
it.
Got the
you
belt
know
going,
like
the USA
it.
Belt buckle going.
You can pull it off. Isaac Howard, a left winger out of the U.S. National Team Development Program. 5'10", 180 pounds. Played at Shattuck in St. Mary's. We've seen Crosby, Parise, Taves, etc. Some famous alum have come from there. And what do you make of Isaac Howard, 31st overall?
Well, what we're seeing here is a quick strike player off the rush, finishing off his chances, right? When he gets into open space, he's got that extra little get up and go, an extra gear, and he loves to sniff out a goal. Like, he's charismatic. You can tell by the suit. This is his personality. He wants to be the guy with the puck on his stick and big boulders.
It's funny you say that because he wears number 3. I mean, how many forwards do you see wear the number 3? He was wearing 53 last year at the U17s, number 3 this year. And he said he was coming with the white suit, JB.
And the belt buckle.
And he's coming with a white suit.
Kyle, what do you have?
Well, Dave, just to add on all of that, so as you see in his highlights, he is someone who has a tough time containing his excitement when he scores goals. As the story goes, when he met with one NHL team during this past season, in the meeting, they asked him to say, how would you rate your goal scoring from 1 to 10? His answer, it's about a 12. So it bears repeating, but maybe not necessary for Lightning fans seeing him walk onto the stage now. This is one confident player coming to Tampa.
He's going to play for a real confident guy in Scott Sandlin, one of the better coaches outside of professional hockey. And one thing I know about Scott Sandlin, he develops players into professionals in a hurry. Tampa Bay owns a Minnesota Duluth player by the name of Cole Koepke, who played for Syracuse this year. He's on the radar to play in the NHL. Koepke's development at Duluth was phenomenal, and I think Tampa's counting on Isaac Howard to have the same kind of development at Minnesota Duluth.
I want to point something out, though, here, just from a scouting perspective. This is a polarizing type of interview, okay? He can mislead some people in the room with his confidence and his approach to real life, and it can scare some people off. This team that he's getting drafted to, they have insulated a winning culture. This is a perfect place for a guy like this with that big personality to go and develop. He'll be a premier player for that.
You think about Benoit Groulx, Gilles Bouchard in the American Hockey League, really comfortable there, doing a great job developing players, and the train keeps on rolling. Tampa Bay has never been afraid to go off the mark a little bit, whether it's Slater Cuckoo or Tony D'Angelo. They've made picks before that might seem a little bit odd, but the players end up usually being pretty good.
We will hear from Isaac Howard. Can't wait to hear that interview in just a matter of moments. But first, a few moments ago, Carolyn Cameron caught up with number 29 pick, Brad Lambert.
With the newest member of the Winnipeg Jets, Brad Lambert, your name's been out there for years. How has that attention helped prepare you for this moment?
Yeah, you know, I think just helped me not to worry too much about what everyone says and just, you know, go do your own thing, get better, and
you know, every day counts, and it's a long process. So just, you know, keep working hard, and you know, I think the results will come.
Your Uncle Lane is now the new head coach for the New York Islanders. Are you especially excited to play a game maybe on Long Island?
Yeah, I mean, hopefully someday, yeah, for sure. Congratulations to him. He's obviously earned it. He's been an assistant coach for a long time, and he knows what he's doing. So he's just got a good coach, and you know, I couldn't be happier to be a part of the Winnipeg Jets.
Well, congratulations. Enjoy.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
All right, Carolyn, so Winnipeg with two first-round picks. The Edmonton Oilers are the final team to pick in this first round. Their pick's coming up in a matter of moments. But let's get you back down, because we do have Isaac Howard live with our Carolyn Cameron.
It's musical chairs down here, David. Isaac, how does it feel to finally be drafted, live out your childhood team, and be going to a franchise such as the Lightning?
Yeah, you know, I can't describe it. To finally, you know, hear my name called by the Tampa Bay Lightning, you know, it's obviously really cool. You know, I'm going to love it out there in Florida, so, you know, I can't complain.
Okay, and you told us you were going to go with the white suit. Is this because your nickname, the Iceman? Is this like a LeBron James thing? What were you going for?
Yeah, you know, the nickname's the Iceman. You know, I think I'm the best-looking guy here, so, you know, I decided to be the best-dressed, too. And, you know, there's not a whole lot of that in hockey sometimes, so there's no reason to, you know, try to change the culture a little bit and get some more fashion in.
White suit will fit in Florida, too, so.
Exactly.
There you go. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Oh, man. Listen, I wish I had that kind of confidence at 50, let alone 18. My goodness. Well, if you're going to have that swagger, right, you got to back it up.
Wow, impressive. He said he was coming with the white suit. He did it. He's got the USA flag and the belt buckle. I mean, to be honest with you, some of that personality is probably what pushed him down, because it wasn't a skill issue with Isaac Howard.
I just think the captain of the Tampa Bay Lightning, Mike Robin, saying this is how we do business here, may not always be like that.
Well, listen, I'm going to play the other side of it and say I like to see some personality. I like to see some guys. You know, we get upset when guys give us the vanilla answers, and he comes out a bit like that. We can't drag him. You better back it up, though. If you got the bravado, you better back it up. So here come the Edmonton Oilers. Remember, they made a trade earlier tonight and moved picks and moved Zach Cassian to Arizona. So they're going to be picking 32nd. Any thoughts here on the Oilers, the very last pick of the first round in this evening in Montreal, gentlemen?
I'm actually surprised that they didn't move back to try and acquire an additional asset when they gave up those two future picks. But they obviously recognize the player that they like and feel that this is going to be the only spot to get him.
Just four picks total for the Oilers. No second, no third, no fourth round pick. So a lot is riding on this pick by Ken Holland, the GM and president of Hockey Ops. Again, a great season into the Western Conference Final versus Colorado this year for the Oilers.
On behalf of the Edmonton Oilers, we'd first of all like to send our condolences out to Kim and the Marchment family. And with the 32nd pick, the Edmonton Oilers are extremely proud to select from the Seattle Thunderbirds, Reid Schaefer.
And there it is, a sixth pick for the WHL. Mom, Lindsay, a school teacher, and Dad, Jeremy, played in the WHL in the 90s. That's been a theme tonight. Both wearing number 24. So he sports number 24. His dad, Jeremy, sported number 24. A great night for Reid Schaefer. The final pick, gentlemen, of the first round of this year's draft.
Well, Reid Schaefer is a big body guy, and he learned to score goals this year playing for Matt Odette and the Seattle Thunderbirds. We talked about that young program on the rise. You'll see Jordan Gustafson go tomorrow. Hey, maybe Brad Lambert shows up there, and all of a sudden you're talking about maybe getting to another WHL final as they did this year against the Edmonton Oil Kings. But that type of big body, power forward type of player is really difficult to find. They're often really expensive on the trade market, and they're really difficult to find. So why not draft and develop that player? With Schaefer, they're well on their way.
My NHL comparable, Nick Paul. Nick Paul, coming out of the Ontario Hockey League, had some deficiencies in his mechanics, his stride. And I think today, after seeing what he did in playoffs, any team in the, well, Tampa Bay signed him to a very cap-friendly deal. I think there's a lot of teams who would love to have him. This kid here is ahead of the curve mechanics-wise. He's close to Nick at the same age, but he's got the same kind of finish. He's going to be, at worst, a 3F.
No, I think this is a real good pick for Edmonton. I really do. You can't teach that size, and his release on a shot is outstanding.
One of the older players in the draft. He's right close to the cutoff of September 15th, so you feel like you have a little bit more certainty in terms of what he's going to be physically and where he is with his mental makeup.
All right, well, the Oilers, their first conference final since 2006, and this is a big man, as you guys have stated. Alex Tuck is actually his favorite hockey player, and imagine if that ends up being where we see Reed Schaefer down the road. That's a pretty good fit on an Oiler team with all sorts of skill, and they can use some physicality as well. So Reed Schaefer, the final pick. We don't call him Mr. Irrelevant. He's the final pick of the first round. And again, we're going to have another 192 picks coming your way tomorrow as well as they round out rounds 2 through 7 in the NHL draft. So we're going to obviously recap and go through all the excitement of what was day one of the draft. I can tell you 6 picks from the WHL, 6 from the U.S. National Team Development Program, and 6 from the Swedish League. So those are our front runners as far as where these picks came from this year. And the fans are still letting them have it as they begin to exit here in Montreal. So an exciting first day, gentlemen, and the trades really maybe stirred things up to get things started. That trade in mid-afternoon between Ottawa and Chicago got the ball rolling. We called it expect the unexpected, and I think that's a fair way to put it.
So many times we go into these drafts and we say, oh yeah, there's going to be lots of trades, and it never really happens. It becomes quiet. But when you look at the salary cap issue in the league with it being stable, you look at teams coming out of COVID and having to make faster pushes to get back into the playoffs to get some revenue, and then you think about the lack of tiers in this draft class, all that led to what we saw with all the chaos tonight.
All right, well, it's been organized chaos down on the draft floor. Elliot Friedman, Jeff Merrick has done a great job organizing it all, and Elliot's standing by with Ken Holland.
Well, Ken, you made a move to move down tonight. You know, you've been busy behind the scenes. You've been working the phones. Tell us how this one with Zach Cassian came to pass.
You know, I love Zach. I mean, obviously, he does a lot of the heavy lifting for us, and he's been there, you know, for a few years, but on, you know, with the pandemic hits and the cap's getting tighter, so had to make a move to relieve some money. So, you know, Zach, we went back three picks and traded a couple picks down the road to relieve some cap space to give us an opportunity to do something here over the next few days.
Now, do you have anything else coming down the pipe over the next 24 to 48 hours, do you think?
Well, we'll see. I don't know. I mean, we've done lots of talk, and we'll see. But right now, for tonight, I'm well, good, and we'll regroup and see where we're at tomorrow.
Thank you very much, Ken.
Thanks, Elliot.
Dave?
All right, Elliot. Well, we saw some picks by the Canadian teams. Philip Massard to Montreal, Brad Lambert to Winnipeg, and Reed Schaefer to Edmonton, wrapping up the first round. And you've been watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal. Much more. We'll put a bow on it. That's coming up next. What a big week it's been in the NHL. Yesterday, of course, they announced their schedule for the coming season. Owen Sound was confirmed as the host city for Scotiabank Hockey Day in Canada, Saturday, January 21st. It'll be the 23rd edition of the show, this time from the Bruce Peninsula. Look how beautiful it is out there. Hard to imagine winter when here it is in the middle of summer. And it was the perfect night here in Montreal, gentlemen, as we're going to put a bow on what was a pretty exciting time. First of all, great to have the fans back. Great to have the atmosphere here in Montreal. A lot of big storylines, though, in the last few hours. What's the biggest one to you?
Has to be Shane Wright. He was projected to go first overall since he came into the entire Hockey League as an exceptional player. And then you look at New Jersey picking at number 2. When Slavkovsky went 1 to Montreal, New Jersey filled the need at number 2 with Simon Nemitz. And then you look at number 3, and they like the dynamic ability of Cooley over Shane Wright. He had to sit there for 3 picks. And finally, the Seattle Kraken, with 2 of their main scouts being located in Kingston, get the opportunity to get this guy. It's hard to say a steal at 4, but I think they got a steal at 4.
Yeah, so, I mean, those storylines are intertwined between that pick and the first pick that went to Montreal. And you look at Kent Hughes, first time as a GM here in Montreal. You look at Jeff Gorton taking over the whole hockey operations. They hit a home run in the sense of the crowd loved what they were seeing, all the moves tonight.
I think anybody that knows the hockey world was really happy with what the Montreal Canadiens did. David, quite frankly, when you look at it, Yaroslav Slavkovsky, big power forward, very difficult to find players like this. His talent, his skill level, his power game, off the charts strong. Then they go out and acquire Kirby Dach from the Chicago Blackhawks for the 13th and 66th pick in this draft. And finally, they take Philip Mazar, who's an absolute game breaker, an animal with the puck on his stick. He can make things happen as a smaller guy in confined areas. I think the Montreal Canadiens did a phenomenal job.
And Jason, what team caught your eye tonight?
The team that I fell in love with their 2 picks was the Minnesota Wild. I love what they did tonight. They got Liam Ogren at 19, the captain in Sweden at the under-18 level. I mean, this kid, he's a character kid. He's a winner. He's a leader. He's already shown the ability to play through injury and pain. I don't want to go there with a big discussion, but it says something about a kid at the hardest time of year when he can fight through that. That was huge. But the other one, I'm telling you, Danila Yurov at 24, this
from
kid
Magnitogorsk
has
the KHL.
This kid Danila might Yurov. End up being, I'm looking at the draft board, he might be right in there with the Cutter Gauthiers and the Shane Wrights, and they might have found another Kaprizov at 24. That kid right there has got star potential.
All right, so Minnesota shaking things up with Bill Guerin. And I say hats off to Kyle Davidson and the Chicago Blackhawks.
Wow.
They came into today without a single first-round pick. They ended up making three trades leading to three picks in the first round. So Kyle Davidson ready to stir the pot. Did trade away DeBrincat to Ottawa. Did trade away Kirby Dach to Montreal. So a lot of moves today as well. It was an exciting night here in Montreal. And in case you missed any of it, here's how it looks on paper. 32 picks in, another 192 are rolling our way tomorrow, rounds 2 through 7. A little bit more coming your way as we continue our draft coverage here on Sportsnet.
You need to find a person to their case.
They're twins?
Yeah, not so sure they're twins. I gotta get off this train.
Make sure to join us next Wednesday, 11:30 a.m. Eastern on Sportsnet. All the news surrounding free agency. It is signing season. We're going to have a full panel. Pierre will be there. Jason, Jennifer Botterill, Anthony Stewart, Colby Armstrong. The insiders, of course, Elliot and Jeff Merrick, our gang from 32 Thoughts. And reporters coast to coast to bring you all the news as it happens, as we can do here on Sportsnet. And what a fun night it was, a historic night here in Montreal, a truly international affair. Players from 9 different countries getting selected. Yuri Slafkovsky becoming the first player from Slovakia to be selected first overall. 32 families tonight, a monumental step on what's been an incredibly long and difficult journey. A time to celebrate a dream come true. Tomorrow, another 192 prospects will find a new NHL home, and NHL fans can start getting excited for the season ahead. For all of us here at Sportsnet, thank you so much for watching the 2022 NHL Entry Draft from Montreal. We're going to see you next Wednesday, 11:30 a.m. Eastern, for Hockey Central signing season. Until then, good night from Montreal. Up next, it is Sportsnet Central. 'Cause we start to let you know.